It's our sixth birthday. Welcome to episode 250 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, an anniversary episode. Let's start with some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hello to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the Tabletop Bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the Tabletop Bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
This episode brought to you in part by our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Join us most Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode250. That's 250. Links may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
So there's a pretty good dang chance that games we talk about tonight will be provided to us by publishers or designers as review copies. Now, all right, with that out of the way, let's talk about tonight and what we're doing today. So we've got some interesting things planned for tonight. And part of that is we're not going to follow our usual format. We're not going to start answering one of your game night questions, even though it's kind of our shtick. Since we're literally 250 episodes in, which is a milestone on its own, and we get new listeners and viewers almost every day, which is pretty awesome, we thought it was about time to recreate a starting point, a welcoming, a where to find us, who we are, a get to know us piece of content, somewhere to point new listeners to.
So that's what we're going to start off with tonight. We're going to record a special Bellhop Backstory episode to be our episode zero, something we can pin to the top of the podcast that'll tell folks who we are, what we do, and answer some of the questions that we get asked over and over again.
That's going to take place of our usual Ask the Bellhop segment.
Then we've got a couple of announcements, a few announcements, probably our longest announcement segment ever, including an upcoming vacation. So again, we said most Wednesday nights, our next public play event here in Windsor, Ontario, for anyone that's in the area or who wants to travel here. And what's a birthday without presents? We have not one, but two new giveaways to announce. Totally last minute on one of them. And for the folks who are awesome enough to join us live, you can expect a couple of very cool door prizes for showing up. So stick around to find out about those.
And then we are going to open the floor up to the folks in the lobby, our chat room here on Twitch, to give you all a chance to ask any questions that you might have. And that's followed by our usual Bellhop's Tabletop segment, where we've got plenty of games to talk about, including public play games, games that I played on a train trip, what Mo and Sean got up to while I was gone.
We wrap up with three reviews: Mare Nostrum Empires from Academy Games, Star Tycoon from Good Games Publishing, and a quick look at the Kettle expansion for Robot Quest Arena.
Yeah, despite it being a birthday, we still have that pile of obligation we got to keep chipping away at. So we decided to throw in three reviews just so we don't fall too far behind.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Today, that question is, what is the Tabletop Bellhop?
So first off, we're a podcast and a website dedicated to answering tabletop gaming questions, providing game night advice, and sharing game reviews.
We are the Dear Abby for tabletop gamers, helping you make your game nights better. Now, at this point, the Tabletop Bellhop has been a thing for 6 years, over 250 podcast episodes, more than 280 game reviews, close to 1,000 written articles on the blog, and who knows how many social media posts, picture shares, reels, and videos.
Yeah, we're also pretty excited that we were nominated as an Origins Awards 2024 finalist for Best Media Production.
Now, every podcast, we answer a gaming or game night question. We talk about the games we've been playing since last episode, and we do two, or sometimes even three, detailed board game reviews. We love all manner of tabletop games and sometimes do dip into RPG territory, but our main focus is on board games.
We also try our best to celebrate diversity in gaming, including game suggestions, reviews, and articles featuring underrepresented groups in the tabletop industry. We strive to be inclusive, supportive, and welcoming to all, and hope we provide safe spaces where gamers can enjoy their hobbies and have maximum fun.
We record our episodes live on Twitch, Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern. If you want to interact with us live and take part in our chat room, that's the place to be. Then Sean magically transforms that recording into an audio podcast, which will drop in the wee hours on Tuesday mornings.
I also take the time to break up and edit the Twitch stream into a bunch of YouTube videos. One for the full episode, one for the Ask the Bellhop segment, and one for each review.
Now, one final note about reviews. You can also find written reviews over at tabletopbellhop.com, our website. Our website's full of game reviews and gaming advice articles and is also home to all of our show notes. Now, the show notes for each episode are very detailed because we try to have links to all of the games we mention, as well as other useful links to things that come up during the episode. There's also a lot of evergreen content there that's worth checking out when you have time.
And as we've been doing this podcasting, we've developed a few rules over the years, what we like to call the Bellhop's Laws. These are things that we've said or mentioned many times on the podcast or come up often in our articles.
So the Bellhop's first law, and a very important rule or philosophy when thinking of board gaming in general, or actually any type of gaming, is that the best games in your collection are the ones that actually get played. Doesn't matter how fancy the game is, how clever the mechanics are, how great the miniatures are, how well-known the designer is. None of that matters if the game just sits on your shelf.
Well, the Bellhop's second law is that the first play of any game, no matter how hard you try, no matter how many times you've reread the rules or how many videos you watch, will be extreme. No one gets a game right on the first time, and sometimes it's 10 games or 10 years later. You discover you've been playing that game wrong all the time.
And then there's our newest law, one that we've learned the hard way, and it's a bit of follow-up to law number two. It's that games are better when you play by the rules. Who knew? Yeah.
So that's kind of our apology to all of the designers and publishers whose games we played wrong over the years. Found out we played them wrong, played by the right rules, and you know what? They were even better. It's almost a universal truth. It's almost like these people actually play test and develop their games and test them before giving them to us. And the rules are there for a reason.
So we've been doing this for 6 years, and a few things have changed over the years, like, say, adding me to the podcast. Yep. So we thought it would be a good time to redo our Origins episode, answer some of the questions we get asked all the time, and tell you a bit about who we are and what we do.
Well, Deanna has gone back and made us a list of some of the most common questions we get asked. Some great get-to-know-you style questions and a good way to get to know our gaming tastes.
So I always find it great to know, as someone who consumes board game media, is I want to know a reviewer's taste in games, what types of games they like, the stuff, type of mechanics they like, if they like heavy or light games and so on. And I also like knowing some of their background, gaming background, as well as getting to know them personally. Heck, if you both enjoy pizza, we're going to at least have something in common before I hear about the games. And I like this because I can compare what they like to what I like and then use that to better judge how useful their content is. Like, not useful, but like, if I know they love social media games, I was also wrong, social deduction games, and I'm listening to it, I'm going, well, yes, they have a bias, they love social deduction games, I don't, so I probably won't agree with this. Or if they are the gamer who loves the heavy thinky brain burning games and they recommend something I thought was a light game, I can think, hey, maybe I should take another look.
All right, so on to question number one. When did you get into gaming?
So while I always played with my family gaming growing up, it was mostly mass market. I didn't actually start gaming until high school, when I started role-playing and playing Warhammer Tabletop with Mo after we'd reconnected after a brief separation at the end of high school, at the end of grade school.
And while I've told the story many times, but you may be hearing it for the first time. So I've always been a gamer. I grew up in a family of gamers, and one of my earliest memories is sitting on my dad's lap while he painted D&D miniatures. My dad was a game collector, and that was the struggles he went through trying to find people to play with and get his collection played that had me help build the local gaming community, originally with the Windsor Gaming Resource and now through the Tabletop Bellhop. I got my love of games from my dad, and now I do my best to pass that on to my own kids.
And for me, it was my mom. We played a lot of mass market games in our house, Trivia Pursuit, Scrabble, so much Boggle, Upwards, you know, all of those good things. And eventually I discovered the Dark Tower, and that was the best game I'd ever seen in my life. And I got into Redbox D&D when I was a kid, eventually, because my mom wouldn't let me buy it at first because she was concerned that I would disappear into the sewers somewhere. So when she would eventually let me get it, I couldn't find anyone that would play with me. And my mom actually ended up being the DM for our small group for a while. So that was pretty cool.
All right. So three favorite games from your childhood. Go.
Cats or Cat's Mansion. Go For It, which is a terrible game. And probably an even worse game that it might not even fit our definition of a game, but something I adored as a little kid was I Want to Bite Your Finger.
Stop Thief, Dark Tower, Redbox D&D.
For me, Spellbaker, Aggravation, and Waterworks.
Waterworks is a good one. My dad had that one. It's still around with the little metal wrenches. All right. Up next, we're going to list our favorite games. We're going to limit it to 10. We're not going to talk about this game. This isn't a top 10 list where we're going to compare and compete and talk about all these games. We're just going to rapid fire these off so you get an idea of what some of our favorite games are.
So, Point Salad, Rallyman GT, The Duke, Pulsar 2849, Azul, DC Deck Building, all of it, Haggis, Takedo, Draconis Invasion, and Eclipse Second Dawn.
All right. I'm going with Marrakesh, Junanog, Trajan, Tapestry, Terraforming Mars, Unfair, Distilled, Race for the Galaxy, Raiders of the North Sea, and of course, Zensu.
All right, in no order, Anachrony, Eclipse Second Dawn for the Galaxy, Wallenstein, Concordia, Lost Ruins of Arnak, Orléans, Adventuria, the Adventure Card Game, The Duke, Marrakesh, and Robo Rally.
All right, so what is a hidden gem that you think everyone should check out?
I'm going to say Zensu every time, usually, but I just put that in the list above, so I'm going to go with Hacienda.
I think that just got a recent reprinting, too, which is good to know.
That's part of why I picked it, because I knew you could actually get it again.
I did not do that for the first game I'm going to recommend, and I'm going to cheat because I can't limit myself to one. I want to do another episode on this, like gems that everyone should try. My number one, though, is a party game of all things, and that is But Wait, There's More from the Bamboozle Brothers. I need this to come back into print. Sorry, Sen and Jay, I have recommended it to so many different publishers. You and Kurt Covert, seriously, Smirk and Dagger, it'd be a perfect game for them.
Would.
Then Garento from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, because everyone should try that game, one of my favorite abstract strategy games. And then the hidden gem deck builder that no one seems to know about, Cowboy Bebop Space Serenade.
And it's not like Japanimation doesn't try and get it out there. I mean, it's at the cons, but we still don't hear anything about it. For me,
no.
While everyone really does know about DC Deck Building, it's huge, you know, everyone plays it. The Injustice game for DC Deck Building never really got any buzz from when it came out on its Kickstarter. And even if you're not interested in getting into the whole DC Deck Building world and thousands of card, Injustice is definitely worth checking out.
What genres or types of games do you not enjoy playing?
For me, real time and also historical games. I don't want a game in reality.
For me, I've said this many times, but again, this is an intro. So social deduction games, most of them, every now and then, there's exceptions. Shadows over Camelot, still fantastic. There are certain ones I like, but overall, most social deduction, Hidden Trader style games. But even more so, the entire range of After Dark. Now I have an excuse to say nasty things and laugh about it and be offensive. No, thank you. Please. I have no interest in that side of gaming.
I really don't enjoy cooperative games. I don't play well with others. I want to be competitive. I have found some cooperative games that I don't mind in the last year, but for the most part, I'd still rather be playing competitive. I hate real time, anything with a speed component, and dexterity games, particularly flicking games. Hell no. Fuse is like the perfect intersection of everything I dread in a board game.
Opposite side, what about genres and types of games you enjoy the most?
Well, for me, that's going to be sci-fi and superhero. Those can make almost any mechanic playable for me.
So I have a degree in classical civ. So ancient civil as a genre always sucks me in. I love a good point salad. I love strategic games that have no one right way to win. And I also enjoy those solve a mystery or escape room in a box type games.
I gotta say, all. Like, I just dig games. I like board games. That's why I have so many games. And I love silly, wacky party games. Like I just talked about, but wait, there's more. I actually love dexterity games. I think Pitch Car is amazing and Hamster Roll is great. I'm all good with real time. I don't have any problem with that. I enjoyed Fuse and I'm really digging Skyrockets from Floodgate. Give me a good puzzle or escape room, though I will admit I like the puzzle escape rooms more than the murder mystery. So there's a little bit of a bias there. Medium weight Euro, I'm in. Meaty heavy brain burner, hell yeah, if I'm in the right mood. Those, it's got to be the right time of day and I got to have enough sleep the night before. What I like most, though, are games that make me think, especially if it's in an interesting new way. Like we say it, it's almost another bellhop meme to say, I like the way this game makes me think. Those are my favorite games. The ones where I'm like, it makes me think differently or think about things differently. Engine builders are usually good at this, where you're trying to figure out how to maximize things. I also like action optimization games. And I love games where it's a puzzle. I really found I adore games where you're eking out that one last move, right? Like Lost Ruins Arnak to me is the epitome of that. The, okay, if I do this, then I do this, that'll let me get this, which will let me do this, which lets me grab this card. And then once I have the card, I can do that. Like that is my, like my favorite moment in a board game is figuring out that move to get that, whatever, 2 points, you know, the two extra points. I adore that.
All right. Well, what game art do you like?
You know, Tool is definitely up there. And Vincent Detrait, the art project from the op just blew me away. Like Vincent Detrait was like on my radar. Everyone talks about the dude all the time and how much I love his art. And I knew what some of it was, but like seeing that, I'm like, okay, never mind. Yeah. Vincent Detrait's up there. I'm a big fan of Quan Chai Moria's stuff, but, honestly, I don't know why it is. I have this big crush on the Miko. So there's this something about his artwork, playing. I think he was at Origins the first time we were there. I can't remember if it was him. And we got a little promo card and it was like, oh, he was too embarrassed to let us put it in the box because he did a self-portrait for this card. I don't know. It's something for the Miko's art. And especially like I watched an interview with the dude. He's not even a board gamer. And I feel bad about that. Like he's like, yeah, I have all these games they send me because they have my art, but I've never played. He was just so humble. I don't know. I will always have a soft spot for the Miko's art.
All right, I'm going with Ian O'Toole because I think his stuff is brilliant for the exact reason. Like I enjoy the art of the Miko, but Ian O'Toole is a gamer.
Yes.
And his layout and design, when he is involved in a game, it actually makes the game better. Like the reprint version of Venos. Am I getting the name right? Because I'm so bad with names. Yeah, the reprint version of Venos. With the Ian O'Toole art, it's actually just a better layout for the board. It makes the game better. His stuff actually elevates the game.
Yeah.
And it's good art.
So for me, interestingly enough, I find if I know who the artist is, it's probably a bad thing. I enjoy good art, but I don't pay enough attention to it unless it is becoming a problem. So I guess in that way, Ian O'Toole might be my favorite because he really does sort of blend in and make it work nicely. All right, favorite food?
The answer is always sushi. I would eat sushi every single day if I could. Sushi.
Yeah, this one, if we had the time and Deanna would let me, I would have a podcast about food. So I got to say pizza is still up there at the top. Seeing as I come from the city with the best pizza in the world, it's kind of hard not to love pizza. Next, though, would be a good pork schnitzel, especially if it's served with hot potato salad. And then ramen is way up there. And I'm still waiting for pining for a local place that is good as Kagero was Solon's old ramen shop. That place was so good and spoiled me from all other ramen I have had. Everything. Nothing has lived up to those standards.
See, and I'm not really sure I could name a favorite food anymore. Used to be easy. It was like, oh yeah, pizza or oh, sushi or yeah, yeah. But to be honest though, there's just so much I enjoy anymore that I just don't have a singular love or standout food. And so many foods, which I despised as a kid, have come back as foods that I actually really enjoy. I had zucchini with dinner tonight and you couldn't have forced zucchini down my throat as a child. So, you know, we all change and grow.
All right. Your favorite movie or TV show?
For me, for TV show, it's got to be Misfits. The UK series, the first 2 to 3 seasons are probably some of the best TV ever made as far as I'm concerned. With movies, I'm going to go with Shawshank, although anything with Tim Robbins could easily go there.
For me, TV, Dragon Prince, Dune, the sci-fi series. I really enjoyed that sci-fi series. And Spawn, the animated series, which I think might have also been sci-fi. It was put out by someone, some network. Young Justice, and then everything Star Wars and Star Trek. Like honestly, I've yet to see a bad piece of media from any of them, because still Star Wars and Star Trek is still better than anything not Star Wars and Star Trek, even if it's not the best Star Wars or Star Trek. And I'm sorry, I'm sci-fi. Deal with it. Other than Trek and Wars movies, I really like messed up foreign films. One of my favorite of all time is Prospero's Books. And I like cyberpunk dystopian thrillers like Gattaca. Or you can mash up the foreign films with those and end up with like Abre Le Ojos.
I could just be like everything Mo said because I watch it all with him. But and a lot of those are my favorites, too. Like, I really dig The Dragon Prince. That's excellent TV. But I'm going to go with Rome, the series that was HBO. I sought it out to have it on DVD and go back and rewatch it and actually listen to the director's commentary for all the episodes. And I've never done that with anything else. So I figure that's got to be a favorite. And I dig the movie Labyrinth.
Fair.
Yeah, that's right. A good one. Labyrinth is a classic. That could have been on my list, too.
Yeah, no, absolutely. All right. Well, we're moving on to a different type of media. Favorite book, name three.
Dune. I've always adored Dune. It's the one novel I've reread multiple times. I don't think any other novel I've read more than once. I will always have a spot for the original Dragonlance Chronicles. That was the first series of books that in grade 6, 7, 8, somewhere in there, I actually chose to read on my own. Like, I sat down in a corner and read a book, and my parents were like, whoa, what's he doing? What's going on? What's in these books? And then my dad read them and got hooked and said, good thing you weren't born earlier, or you'd be named Tasselhoff. And then for an odd one, but I adore this book, was Beowulf, a new verse translation by Seamus Heaney. The interesting thing is, when I double check the name of that book, there is a newer translation by a woman that I really want to check out now. That is the follow-up and the answer to Seamus's version. So I need to find that at some point.
I am a book person. Our house is full of shelves of my books. It's really hard to pick three things. Yeah. I'm going to go with anything by Charles Dillant, Tam Lin by Pamela Dean, and The Cat Who Walks Through Walls by Robert Heinlein.
Yeah, it's a fantastic Heinlein. For me, I too am a book lover. I have recently moved to more digital because of, well, physically moving, and books are heavy and take up a lot of space. But I reread a lot of books. Like, Mo's like, oh, the only book I've ever reread is Dune. I'm like, I've reread most books. I will reread a lot of books. But for me, the top three are Snow Crash by Neal Stephenson, Who is Bugs Potter by Gordon Corman, which I just recently discovered you can't find anymore. It's really not in public. It's not actually being published. And Player of Games by Ian M. Banks. Not Ian Banks, Ian M. Banks, because M means it's science fiction.
Okay. You mentioned Snow Crash. I got to admit, I have reread Neuromancer multiple times. I forgot about that one. Neuromancer is a book where I start reading it and I'm like, man, this guy writes like a mess. And then halfway through, you just get used to his verse. It's like reading Shakespeare. You know, partway through, you stop missing the old English. You're like, no, now I'm on the same page. I enjoy this book. All right, next one. How did we all meet?
Long, long ago in a galaxy far, far away when I was 6 years old.
Yeah, Sean and I met in grade school. That was a long time ago. Deanna was, of course, much later. Met her through a local BBS where I was trying to set up a text-based game of Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. The BBS, for those local, was Spine of the World, recently renamed to Megadeth. We did go to the same high school, but basically got to know each other through the doors and chat on the BBS.
Yeah, and we started dating when we were in high school and eventually got married and have kids and a podcast and large game collection.
Did you meet your wife over the internet? I'm like, yes, just that we didn't really call it the internet back then.
I think it is kind of wild that we went to the same school. We were even in some classes together, but we connected because we were both online and chatting online.
All right. So how, why did we start a podcast?
This one's on Sean.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
is 100% Sean.
This one was my fault. So the initial impetus for it all was me listening to a bunch of podcasts and thinking that, well, Mo has this wealth of gaming knowledge to share. He is a, you know, walking board game geek. In the website, not just a board game geek as a person, also I just wanted to spend more time chatting with my longtime friend because we were living, you know, 4 hours apart. We rarely saw each other, and it seemed like him sharing his knowledge would be a good excuse for me to talk to him.
Yeah, and we put it off for a long time, but then my day job got downsized and I found I had a lot of free time and a very good severance package that afforded us the opportunity to try to do this thing full time. And I'm still like 6 years later, we're still doing this. That's still amazing. I cannot believe it worked. Thank you for letting me go, company I used to work at. It ends up, it was the best thing that could have happened.
Yeah, I remember specifically that we all went to Breakout Con together. Yes. And we were sitting there having breakfast. And we were like, all right, you know what? Sean's been on you about this thing to do a podcast for forever. That's it. I'm going to make you do it. And then, like you said, a couple months later, everything in our life was upheaval. And we went, let's roll with it. Let's see what happens. We are living a wild life.
Yes.
Okay. We get asked this one fairly regularly. Do you have merch?
For so long, we said no. But now, yes, finally, this is something new we have started in the last year. We have merch. That is right. You can get our logo on things, including like the shirt I'm wearing right now. Folks have been asking about this for a while. We finally got it all in place from a Canadian supplier, too, which is pretty awesome. We have merch. This includes Tabletop branded stuff. Our mugs are our most popular item. I don't have one of our mugs from there. From what I understand, there's only one logo instead of two. We have cool board game related t-shirts that are being designed by my daughter Gwen, which is kind of awesome. I'm personally in favor of the cats jumping on a bed shirt inspired by Boop, and I've got to pick up at some point the yellow pieces are mine shirt so that I can stop arguing with people when we show up to game nights and people want to take my yellow from me.
All right, will you ever have a Bellhop Con?
So probably not. We're really not interested in large event planning side of things. But if you're looking for people to organize and teach gaming at your con, well, that's a different story.
Yeah, I think the closest we'll ever get is to an official Bellhop event or a get together. I could definitely see potential of a get together is something at a bigger event, right? At a local event. Just this year at Origins, we had a get together for our fans. It was the first time we've ever done that. And that was awesome. We got together, we had some pizza and beers and other drinks, and we played some games. Well, a game. Played a bunch of caution signs. Great game. That's the kind of thing I think you'll be able to expect from us. Now, we may end up having some other involvement in local events that will have a Bellhop section. So just this year, a bunch of local stores got together and created an event called The Summoning. And I can totally see having a Bellhop get together and game night as part of The Summoning or after hours. You know, once they got the night market going, we all go somewhere and play in a game. But I don't think you're going to find a, you know, gathering of friends style Bellhop con specifically. That is just not my forte. I am not in a local, small local single night events. Yes. Big cons. No.
All right. Well, what is your favorite episode or favorite review that we've done over these 6 years?
Episode 233, where we talked about the best escape room and mystery games. I dug that one because it was one of the first ones where I came on as a full host. I had more of a hand than usual in creating the show notes for it. And I am more passionate about mystery games than Mo is. He doesn't dislike them per se, but I don't think it is something we would be reviewing or doing on the podcast if it wasn't for the fact that my mom and I really like playing them. So, yeah, that's one of my favorites.
And no, it's not because Sean was not on that episode.
I was biting my tongue. I wasn't going to say it. So I may be biased, but I love my look at Super's RPGs and the interaction it's gotten as a topic and as an episode. And that's Super's Capes and Metas, a look at 9 superhero RPGs, which is episode 125.
I got to say, that's the gift that keeps on giving. We constantly get comments on that post. We touch some nerves in that particular episode. I know, favorite episode. I don't know. I love all my children, but I do have a favorite review. I'm sure there are episodes I enjoyed. I can't think of any on the top of my head. There was one we did where we had everyone get together after in the chat room, and we got to hang out with like Math Guy Dave and Red Meeple Ryan and a bunch of that was a lot of fun. That was one of our birthdays or anniversaries. I don't even remember. It might have been New Year's. I don't even know. But that was one. But more importantly, I am going to go with a review. And that is our review of Scythe from Stonemaier Games. And that's because of the journey that was Scythe. This is a game I did not enjoy. And anytime someone's like, what's a popular game you hate? I'm like, yeah, Scythe. Because my first experience with that game was terrible, like really bad. And it wasn't even just one try. I tried the game 3 times. So it's not like I won and done and I didn't understand what was going on. But our fans kept speaking up, right? Anytime I would bash Scythe, there'd be some I wouldn't say fanboys, but people in the chat were like, no, you got to try Scythe again. You got to try Scythe again. So we eventually did take the plunge, tried Scythe again, and ended up loving it. The first game was still a little rough, but it was better than I remembered. But the more I got into the game and got to understand it and the way the game played and realizing that it's not, you know, the war game it kind of sells itself as, the fact only winning 2 battles matters and so on. That journey made that review worth it for me. And I think it's that journey that also appeals to our fans because it is our most popular review of all time on the blog. And I think it's because it's got that backstory to it. We're not just going, here's how you play, here's how you do this. You're like, I hated this game and here's why I love it. So that's to me, it's one of our top pieces of content. So I love it for that reason. Plus, it just the journey of Scythe was an entertaining one.
And with that, we come to the end of our most asked questions list and the end of this special Bellhop backstory segment.
The goal of this episode was to help you get to know us a bit better, both what we do and who we are as people and gamers. Now, our entire goal as a podcast is to answer game night questions. So if you've got a question for us, you can send that question to questions@tabletopbellhop.com or just reach out to us anywhere on the web.
Your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, where you can click on Ask the Bellhop and send in your questions. But we're also all over the web and social media as Tabletop Bellhop, one word. You can find us on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
We've also got a Discord. You can actually send questions there and interact with us real time. Usually at least one of us up and on at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
And we have a Patreon where you can get cool stuff like copies of our pre-production show notes, first thoughts reviews, bonus audio, and more.
Thank you all for so much for joining us. Good day.
And game on.
And now an announcement from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
Tir na n'og has proven to be hot, like super hot, like ridiculous. Maybe some fae cast a spell hot. You know how much we enjoyed the game. We talked about it. Yes. We found the theming a little different, but we loved the gameplay, the mechanics in this game. It keeps bringing us back for more. Deanna and her mom loved this game. And, well, it's not just us. Mark brought everything he shipped to Origins, sold out the first day, I think it was, or second day, like completely sold out. He's like, I'm not going to make the same mistake at Gen Con. I am going to ship everything I have, the entire print run, sold out of that too. He said for the first time ever, there was a lineup at his booth for one of his games. Never had that before. And that is an awesome milestone. Like there's one of the reasons I wish we were at Gen Con, just to have seen Mark and this crowd lined up to get Tir na n'og.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. It's a fantastic game. It's definitely one of my favorites in the past year. Earlier this week, Grand Gamers Guild announced that they have decided to go back to Kickstarter for a reprint campaign, which is also a chance to release some additional content.
Through this Kickstarter, Grand Gamers Guild hopes to reprint the original deluxe edition of Tir na n'og with premium components and 2 new mini expansions, subplots, and towers. There are plans for multiple small modules as a new 18-card escape room adventure called Journey to Tir na n'og.
The campaign's going to run from the 13th of August to the 6th of September. Sign up now to be notified on launch through the link that we're about to drop in the show notes. and we'll have in the chat.
And if you dig their games, you can also help Grand Gamers Guild out by going to the SM preview list over on BGG and giving their games a thumbs up. And you will also be able to find a link to that in the notes and the chat.
We will not be recording next week, August 14th.
Yeah, every year we take a family vacation up north for a week at my uncle's farm, and it's falling on this week. We actually leave on Sunday. This is the one time a year we pretty much disconnect, and I plan to do as little work as possible, except for maybe play a ton of games in our pile of obligation. So we'll have lots to talk about when we come back.
We should be back here live on Twitch on the 21st, and I hope to see everyone here in the lobby.
The very next day, the 22nd, we're hoping that hosting the next Brews and Board Games event at the Walkerville Brewery.
And here's the one that I think people are going to be way more excited about other than us just, you know, taking off for a week. Our next giveaway is live. If you've happened to visit tabletopbellhop.com, you've probably seen it already.
For our 6th birthday, we are having a special giveaway where the winner gets their pick from a list of 6 of our favorite games from the past year. What we did is we each picked 2 of our favorite new-to-us games that we've played since last July, limited to games that are currently in print and readily available, and then here's the list we came up with.
So for the 2 games I went with The Artemis Project, a fantastic worker placement, dice placement game, and Decorum, which is something we recently just started diving into, and I am absolutely loving the puzzle aspect of this.
So I picked The Art Project, which is just a fantastic cooperative game featuring stunning Vincent Dutrait art and Sushi Go Party. Now, this is a game we haven't even actually reviewed on the show, but it is such a fantastic, lightweight, enjoyable party game that I'm going to see if we can try and get a copy to bring out for our Walkerville nights.
And I picked Zensu, which I know you've never heard of this game. And those of you who listen to the podcast, right? Shocking. Okay. Zensu from Outset Media and Star Tycoon, which we have just recently been diving into and I've really been digging.
We will be drawing one winner who will get to pick from those 6 games. Head over to tabletopbellhop.com/birthday to enter.
Now, I will say that, I love Star Tycoon. It wasn't my first choice for the giveaway. I wanted to go with Tir na n'og from Grand Gamers Guild, but as we were just talking about, it's sold out everywhere, so I can't get a copy to give away.
Or can we? You know that new Tir na n'og Kickstarter we were just talking about just in the last segment? Well, Mark from Grand Gamers Guild was awesome enough to let us do a giveaway for an all-in pledge for the Kickstarter. Now, again, the Kickstarter doesn't launch until the 13th. You can go there now and kind of take a look at it. You can follow. And if you are selected as winner, you will have to back at the $1 backer level. That just makes shipping and organization and everything a lot easier on Mark's end. So technically, if you win the right to purchase the Kickstarter for $1. Now, unfortunately, due to shipping restrictions, we are going to limit this one to US and Canada because the cost to ship overseas is a little too ridiculous. Sorry, international friends.
Now, this is its own separate giveaway, which you can enter over at tabletopbellhop.com/grand.
And then we've got one final birthday surprise to announce. We've got new merch.
So to help celebrate our 6th birthday, Gwen has created 3 new t-shirt designs, each based off games we love.
We have a Grinto-inspired shirt, a shirt inspired by Endangered, and a shirt inspired by Zensu.
You can find these new shirts at tabletopbellhop.com/merch. Well, now that you've heard our backstory and gotten to hear our answers to some of our most frequent questions we get asked, it's time to open things up to our lobby here on Twitch and do a short AMA segment.
Yeah, we're probably going to aim for about half an hour here, and then we'll call it quits, or if the questions die off, we don't get any good questions. Thank you, everyone, who's already sent in questions earlier in the episode. You are still free to send in more. Just make sure you use hashtag ask, A-S-K, before your question so we can sort it through the scrolling of text by our very full chat room. So what do we have?
All right, well, first up from Tech2674, what is your favorite moment over the last 6 years?
Origins. Going to Origins as a content creator for the first time. That was both humbling and very ego boosting at the exact same time. Like from we're not so big a deal and hearing no one off a lot. And who the heck are you? And what are you trying to pull asking us for review copies, to people recognizing us, pointing out they've known, you know, followed me for years on Google Plus and are fans of the show. The feeling of just I loved Origins. Like, I almost want to go back, but it was before that we went to Origins not being content creators, because we weren't. Just that feeling of everyone around me shares a hobby, where you find out the gaming community really is a community and mm-hmm. you're part of something. That feeling of belonging, and just how accepted we were overall and how open people were to share information, and how great the tabletop content creator community is in general. Sure, there are probably some bad apples, but in general, most people are awesome and just excited about the hobby and want to share it.
Being nominated with the Origins Award, that was pretty cool. Yeah. I really, like, along the same lines, I really enjoyed going to Gamma Expo this year. Like, as much as I like Origins, Gamma Expo was the sweet spot for me. And I get that's you can only go there if you're in the industry and it's not open to everyone. So maybe me talking it up isn't as nice. But I mean, like, the game nights there are fantastic. And we got to try so many games. Boy. And everyone was just welcoming and inclusive and an awesome vibe. And the seminars and the learning stuff was cool. I loved it. I loved everything about it. I was exhausted. We went for like 12 hours a day. No, more than 12 hours a day. We were going from like 8 in the morning until midnight and walked so many steps. My Fitbit thought it was kidnapped. But that was for me. Yeah.
For me, it's a little different because, again, I'm just kind of, I don't want to say I'm not a part of the show. I'm absolutely a part of the show, but I'm not as part of the gaming industry and that stuff. So, what's fun and enjoyable is going to Origins and not being recognized, because I'm not the one who's being recognized, but seeing people walk up to us and seeing people walk up to Mo and introduce themselves to Mo and say that they're fans of the show, even though, you know, I am a part of it and I take pride in a lot of the effort I put in to making this show work and getting it out to people and getting the videos up there. And so even though it's not me that they're recognizing, the fact that we are getting recognized as a group, as content creators, is just fun. And even if it's Mo that they're going to recognize, because Mo is the face, Mo is the tabletop bellhop, having him be recognized feels just as good to me. And so that I was getting a kick out of that this year at Origins.
Sean actually just only does this because we have blackmail on him and we coerce him.
Some other favorite moments. I got to say, our meetup was awesome. It wasn't nearly as big as we were hoping, but that was cool. The people who showed up were passionate and we had a great time. And I hope that just grows next year. Maybe we'll find another venue. Maybe we'll stay there. We did happen to find some really cool places within walking distance that we may be looking into for next year. Gamma's huge, actually. Like, I was talking about Origins and talking about how welcoming everyone is and how awesome everyone is. And I'm like, while I'm saying it in the back of my head, and I'm like, well, no, Origins was better, or Gamma was better. Because, like I say, the vibe of the whole, you know, rising tide thing that was at Gamma, the fact that it was, we are all members of this organization, all here to help each other and make the industry better, was such a vibe there. Like, that was the entire point of the whole show. Yeah, sure, there were some retailers there that were just trying to get some early pre-orders, and there were publishers there that just wanted to, you know, sign deals. But that was not the focus. That was, like, the thing that also happened. Well, everyone was just celebrating being a board gamer. Like, it was just such an awesome vibe. Like, I everyone says you got to go to Gen Con, and I still think if you're a content creator, if you're a publisher, if you're a retailer, you got to go to Gamma.
All right. Well, next up, we've got a question from Charlie Brown Windsor. How have each of you developed or improved over 250 episodes?
I now speak live on camera, and I have yet to drop. So I deserve a cookie, because when we first launched, I couldn't come into the guest chat or even be on the, well, the after show got the explicit tag, because every time I open my mouth, I have sailor mouth. So I'm quite proud of myself that I managed to get through this many episodes and haven't mucked up yet.
This was driven mainly by Sean. Sean has been pushing to do more succinct reviews that are less verbose, with less detail and less turn by turn. Here's where you place the piece on the proper shape on the board. And I've got to say, especially this week in particular, we cover a fairly heavy game. And I think I did a really good job of keeping it succinct while still getting across everything you need to know to decide if you want the game or not. Now, written reviews, I'm probably still going to be big and long because that's what we get the praise on. We get told, like, people love the long written reviews and the detail because, well, it's easy to scroll by what you don't care about. Whereas the video and the audio, it's a little harder to skip ahead. Like, you can do it, but then it's rough, right? Like, and you're probably just going to skip to the end instead of skipping ahead, and we don't want that. So I got to say, I think my ability to write more succinct reviews is something that I think we've definitely developed and improved on.
For me, it's editing. I mean, that's kind of what I do the most of. And so my ability to edit neatly, cleanly, and efficiently, I think a large part, has really improved. I've developed all different workflows and ways of doing things, and I keep trying new things. But being able to get a podcast put together in video and audio format and get it out, and not have it, you know, and have us sound good, and apparently people like us because they keep listening to us, so I'm doing something right. Even though we don't get a lot of reviews and we don't get a lot of specific comment on whether or not it's working, I think the fact that we don't get hate, or when things go wrong every once in a while, you know, something is wrong in the audio, and we do hear about that. So in some ways, you know, not hearing anything means I'm doing my job right.
Our ability to have scripted text and not sound like we're reading, I think, is something when we listen to our older episodes, we have definitely gotten better at.
I'm still getting there. I only started doing the talking thing this spring.
Yeah, it's only been since March that Dee has been on the show and using show notes. Anytime she had been on the show previously, she was just talking off the cuff.
I refuse to be scripted. I'm like, nope.
I still, part of me wants to try the episode where we script like almost nothing and see how it goes, but I don't know. We also get comments that people like the mashup of open discussion and scripted or planned content.
Well, we stay on target for the most part. I think people appreciate that.
So what has been the journey as a media member, GAMA member, or integrated as press?
Press and GAMA member have nothing to do with each other. They are two totally separate things. So as a GAMA member, we may get an advantage, and we do get free passes to these cons, but they're not necessarily press passes. We still have to apply as hosted media or press. Neither kind of two different now, things.
We applied and we are in the media branch of GAMA, though. We are GAMA media members, which we wouldn't be unless we were content creators. So, I mean, there is overlap there, but
there's overlap. The GAMA press has a different connotation.
Yeah.
Because media members means you create content. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be con coverage content or whatever, right? Media member also, it has events. It's actually media and events is what we're under. And if we just hosted local game nights, we could be members. I'm pretty sure we could actually have joined GAMA as Tabletop Bellhop, who hosts events in Windsor, Ontario, in the events side of the media and events. The thing, I don't know. GAMA has been interesting. It is not cheap, but I think it has been so worth it. And not for the reasons I thought it would. When we joined GAMA, one of the things I was looking for was validation. It's not the right word. Cred. I've drawn a blank on the word. By being able to go, we're a GAMA member, people would respect us more, right? Would be like, oh, they're GAMA.
Yeah, we can put a badge on our website.
Right. Like, put a badge on our website. It would make us more official, right? Like, it would make us more of an authority, which maybe it did. I have no idea if it had any impact like that. But then going to GAMA events and interacting with GAMA members and seeing the newsletters they put out, and there's way more we could do, because one of the big things with GAMA is the more you put into it, the more you're going to get out of it. Mm-hmm. We could probably be spending 4 hours a day watching seminars on various things. It probably would help us, but again, you have to put the time in to do it. The amount of stuff they do, like once a month, they send out their newsletter, and there's just tons of information in there. And that whole rising tide thing, like every GAMA member is there to help out the other GAMA members and just make the entire industry better.
So I think it just makes us really feel like we're part of the industry and not just like some onlookers.
Are you training a second generation to fill your shoes, sandals, or boots?
Yep, definitely. I don't have a lot to say about that, but yeah. Not intentionally. Same thing we've talked about many times before. If you do have kids, don't force them to game. We have never forced our games to play. I will admit some frustration recently with our youngest daughter who hasn't been interested in playing games, which is all the power to her, but it's making getting some of those reviews done a little harder because it's one less player in our household. But yeah, Gwen in particular, if you come out to any of our local events, she's there with the Bellhop shirt on teaching games alongside mom and dad and Sean. Like she is as much a part of our public play events as any of us. She helps pick the games we bring. She notes down which ones she can teach. She greets people. She introduces herself. Like, she is doing a fantastic job.
And she plays 90% of the games we review and will give me detailed and interesting viewpoints into those games. And she's our in-house artist, which I dig. And yes, I will point out, I pay her for that, a good, decent going rate, because I would not make her make art and then sell it and not pay her. That would not be cool.
Yeah, no child labor here. She is also paid to help at our events.
What is the most positive change in the hobby over the Bellhop years, so these last 6 years?
It's got to be the amount of inclusivity and diversity we are seeing at events in general, everywhere. Publishers, games coming out. We just did our episode on the best games by women game designers, Elizabeth Hargrove's impact, her list of 200 women game designers, but not just there, like just going to cons, going to events, even our public play events. There is a shift since we started this. It has gotten better and better. We're seeing more neurodivergent people out. We're seeing more minorities out, not just women. We're seeing local gaming groups that are more diverse than I've ever seen in my life, which is awesome.
Yeah, all of that. Less poignant, but it's way easier to play games online now. BGA's got everything, man. So that's a positive change. It's a lot of games on BGA that I do not want to learn there. But once you already know the game, it's a fun place to go play them.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll be interested at some point. I'm going to have to try Distilled on Board Game Arena, because I do know Distilled, and see how that experience goes. Because, yeah, as Dee said, learning games on Board Game Arena has proven to be less than ideal.
It's bad. Don't do it. And every time we think it won't be that bad, let's try it one more time. And then it's bad. Don't do it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's been fantastic seeing the change, just even in my smaller view of the thing. I don't have the same reach and expanse and experience in gaming as Mo and Dee do. But going back to my first breakout con and seeing the reaction of people to Dee and Dee's experiences at that con versus the number of women teaching games, exploring games, they're visiting and learning games at our most recent Origins. It's really night and day. And Breakout Con is a diverse, welcoming con, but there were still problems. Whereas Origins was so different. And I still remember the guy who came up to you and said, I don't usually see people, women smiling at these events.
Yeah.
You look like you're happy. That's quite strange. Yeah, I would say even like compared to the first year that we went to Origins, which I think was in like 2016, it was pre us doing Bellhop. And just even the first year we went to Origins compared to this year going to Origins, I felt like there's just more and more women there. It's cool to see.
Yeah, and on both sides, too, like on the publisher side, too. I think we had more meetings with women than we did with men when meeting with publishers this year. So it's just definitely a thing. And again, minorities as well. We weren't sitting with old white guys telling us about their latest games, right? That just didn't really happen much. Other things we've seen improve. One of the things I love is the access to designers just keeps getting better and better. Like pretty much everyone's on the internet now and on social media. And most of them are, of course, on Board Game Arena. And it has gotten so easy to get an answer from the right person now that it is awesome. Like if you have a rule question, last night before this, like if we had recorded last night, there was a section of this next segment that would have been different, but I made a post on BoardGameGeek and got an answer before I went to bed last night about a rule question I had, because I was going to complain about something in a game. And I'm like, well, am I misreading the rules or is there something here? The ability to access publishers, designers, all of that, the access to the industry is just keeps growing, which I think is awesome. Like, everyone's out there and available and willing to help. And I dig that.
Now, interestingly, I'm going to use this to pivot into the second part of Pax's question, which is, what is the worst change? Now, we as a group don't like to badmouth things. We don't like to talk down. Really, we're here to boost the industry and help mm-hmm. everyone improve. But there are things that could still improve. Yep. And one of the things I've really seen as a change in these past 6 years is a shift in some board games towards the, I call it the video game release method, where you can patch it later. So releasing games that aren't quite ready, aren't quite done. The FAQs grow on Board Game Geek, or, you know, the forum questions are just filled with all these people asking questions, because it is easy to access these designers. Yeah. And sometimes it's too easy, because you need to access these designers because the rule books haven't been necessarily as well and completely written as they could be.
Crowdfunding and Kickstarter doesn't seem to be as big a thing as it was. Mm-hmm. But it's still there. There's still games. Like, come on, we're having a giveaway for a Kickstarter. Some publishers are still using them, but it doesn't seem to be the big hype train, massive. There's these huge, massive games. Now, on RPG industry is different. They still seem to be all in on crowdfunding. But for board games, it just seems like it's unfortunately, it's now just a pre-order system for a bunch of publishers, and that's where you expect their games to go. But the exclusivity, the Kickstarter exclusive, mm-hmm. get it all now or you're going to miss out, seems to have really died down. And
it's, you can still get there. Most of
the stuff in just retail.
Lower.
I think one thing I heard recently is the loss of Luke at Kickstarter.
Yeah.
Has hurt the board game industry's impact on Kickstarter. I know people had differing opinions about his effectiveness and work at Kickstarter, but I've seen from publishers that there has been a decrease in the quality of some of the board game stuff, and just sort of a more generic wash of games as opposed to some of the curation that was happening right. while he was there.
One of the things we haven't seen that seems to have kind of backtracked as well was app-driven games. That was a big thing. Everything was app-driven for a while there, and that seems to have died off. And I thought that was interesting. I kind of thought it'd keep going there. There are still some out there, but again, there's not that. For a while there, it was starting to feel like every game was going to need an app to be able to play it, and I'm glad that never actually happened.
Oh, you know what is a positive change that's happened? I mean, we're not doing this, but the fact that basically any game you get now, you can go find a walkthrough or a playthrough yeah. video. That wasn't necessarily true 6 years ago.
I think the app thing, I think a lot of companies started realizing quickly how expensive it is yeah. to maintain mm-hmm. an app over the length of your game. Because if you that's want your exactly game to last it. Forever, you mm-hmm. have to pay web hosting fees forever.
I was talking to a publisher, and they said it wasn't the initial upfront cost of creating the app, but that they didn't realize what they were getting into with the long term,
yeah,
having it to maintain it, and that they would never do an app driven game again.
Yeah, those little costs add up, whether it's, you know, your hosting fees and your, you know, registering your domain and renewing your domain and all the little bits and bobs that come along with what it takes to run a website or an app. They're very similar in many ways, and, you know, your data costs and it adds up.
All right. Well, I think that's probably enough for today. And if we didn't get to your question or you have more to ask, remember, you can always just go to the website and click Ask the Bellhop, or email questions@tabletopbellhop.com, or hit us up on social media, where you can find us everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So one of the big things that happened since we last recorded was our last Walkerville Brewery Brews and Board Game Game Night. This had the best attendance we've seen since our inaugural, which could have been because it was inaugural, but it was also on a long weekend. So this did really well. Nice crowd, ton of different games played. And people like showed up to game. Like this wasn't, they wandered in the brewery and there happened to be a board game event. These were people that were intent and they knew what they wanted. Some of them obviously like had read the menu online before coming and were like, I'm here to try this. Came to play specific games and types of games, which was good to see.
Yeah, I sat at the table with Sean and it was 2 weeks ago and I already can't remember what I talked to who. But what I do remember is many people coming up and just having really interesting, engaging conversations about the games on the table and how they were picking them and and what they were looking for in games. And I really enjoyed all of that, probably the most out of any of our walkable events. Yeah.
Yeah. And then on top of that, there were a few people who were just there to have some drinks with friends and to play, you know, oh, look, let's play some board games while we're here. And I got my Go Cuckoo teaching to a bunch of girls who were just there to, you know, have some drinks and have some fun. And that's awesome as well. It's just great seeing that people play the games.
Yeah, there was a lot of teaching for all of us. Like I taught so many games. Smug Owl, Shadow Ninjas, Racco, Crooked Crown, Fantastic Factories. Hey, That's My Fish, Boop multiple times, Go Cuckoo I taught, Decorum a couple times, Planet. I think there were probably more.
I think one of the things that amused me was I taught my mom and Genevieve to play Decorum. And when they were done, Genevieve was like, can we go home and play it again? Can I play it? And I was like, well, it's a scenario-based game and mom's already played the first so many scenarios with dad, so I can't really. And she's like, well, what can we do? And when can I play it again? Like she was so hooked on it. So I was amused by that.
Now, Sean mentioned groups that weren't there to game. So there's this one table. It was about six people ranging in age. Like I now know it was a couple with their parents and their kids there all at once. And then they were from overseas and the parents were visiting. And I approached them and I'm like, are you here for the event? And they're like, no, just the beer. And I'm like, OK, which I thought was a little odd with the little kids, but whatever. It's a public venue. Probably just have a flight and head out. But then I walked away and I came back with Catch the Moon. And I was like, are you sure? And they were like, oh, what's this? And I just started setting it up in front of them. And they played that until they left. Like, I don't know how many games of Catch the Moon went on. There was at least four, probably like 10 or 15, like this table. And eventually the grandparents left with the kids and the couple was still there playing for a little while. And before they left, they came over and like, well, thank you so much for bringing this over. This made our evening. So that made me feel pretty good. That was me doing the thing I used to do when I ran 4E D&D, where people would walk into the store and I'm like, you playing D&D now. Here's a character sheet. And it worked. Yeah. So that was awesome.
That's pretty cool.
Well, teaching full games I got in. It wasn't a lot, but I did play a full round of Smug Owls and Lost as the Guard Dogs in a game of Shadow Ninjas. Because, man, these people just were surging certain ninjas way ahead. And we're like, we're just going to push him all the way to the front. And the rules were terrible.
I thought it was interesting that we finally got people to play Smug Owls. Yes. I did not just merely show it to people who went clever and then walked away. People actually played Smug Owls this time. And it seemed to go over really well.
Yeah, we got it to the right groups this time, I think is what it was. We had the groups that enjoy those type of social games. And there was a trio of people who were like, we'll play anything, but it's got to be social. There's got to be lots of interaction. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the tables. And then there's a group of younger gamers who come out to almost all of our events that are really into those. Take that games or like I see you've got crabs and unstable unicorns and bears versus babies and all those type of games. They adore Go Cuckoo, and I swear we sold them a copy of Go Cuckoo by the end of the night, and we'll never see them out at an event again, because I think that might have been the only reason they showed up was to play our copy of Go Cuckoo. Next up, after the event, was a three-player game of Hamburg at Brenda's. I'm still loving it. The more that I play it, the more I'm getting over the fact that they removed one of my favorite things from Bruges. For the big change here is instead of having two decks where you have to pick off the top of one or two decks, you have access to all the colors of cards all the time. And no, I'm starting to like it because it does help with long-term planning and planning your turns and strategy and hedging your bets on what you're going to get. But oh my God, the iconography in this game is overwhelming. I might go so far as say horrible, and I don't know how they could fix it. During this play, what we found out we need is five copies of the addendum book, because then everyone can be looking up their cards, because you do the draw phase and then you sit back and wait as everyone passes the book around, because the icons are so I don't know. They're once you read what it means, you go, okay, yeah, okay, I can see that. But like that happens every time. And even as we play more and get to know some of the iconography, there's subtle little differences, which means we still have to look up every card just in case.
Yeah, there is no way they could handle this better and still have it be language independent. And yeah. Honestly, I would pay extra to get extra copies of that book. The answer is to have it in PDF, but not on your cell phone. That's too tiny, like on on a tablet. OK, the thing is, like, we've now played it twice. And or maybe it was three times, I feel like I'm starting to know the iconography, like it makes sense. Right. So late on into that last game at my mom's, I'm like, I don't need to look this card up. I know what it means. It means something very similar to a card I played earlier. It makes sense that this is what it means. And then I went to play it and you said, Deanna, that doesn't seem quite right. And we looked it up and it did not mean what the, like, it was very clear. It said, do this three times. And it was like the iconography seemed like it made perfect sense, but it's do this three times, but only if X and Y was how it actually played out. And so you literally have to read the description for each card to play the game accurately. And I still love the game. It's amazing. I can't wait to play it again.
Yeah, and we totally scared Sean away from this game by talking about this.
I know. And I'm like, come on. To be honest,
I have to say, and this is my experience playing the Feld games has not been great, I have to say. Well, it's not Queen games because I really love Dabba Walla, but the Feld games in particular are proving to be not my cup of tea. So it's good that Gwen is back because Gwen likes these kind of that kind of games, and you guys can get more plays in without making me struggle to pretend I enjoy a Feld.
So I've got this new chair and it's got these restraints built into it.
Still should try it once before we review it. It might be the Feld that wins you over. I highly doubt Hamburg would be. New York City, I think, is more your style of game, but we'll get to that. Know what I actually want? I want an app where I put in the card number and it shows me a picture of the card and tells me in text. Like, so the Queen needs to pay someone to develop an app, though I know we just talked about why people aren't doing apps as much. But that's what I want. I want an app for that game. Even better, let me scan the card, like just scan the card with my thing and tell me what it does. So if they ever put Hamburg on Board Game Arena, I'm going to love it. I think that's the end result. If I can have tool tips with my game of Hamburg, I would be enjoying it way more.
I hadn't thought of that because that's when I fell in love with Castles of Burgundy, when you can just tool tip over it and it tells you what everything does. That would be fantastic.
Next up, something we all enjoyed instead, that three-player game of Star Tycoon, which is, I got to say, our hotness right now. Multiple plays since the last time we were here, including trying out the trading rules. So this is just a really solid tableau builder with a fun and interesting market. And we're going to review it later tonight. So I'm not going to say too much more.
I called it out as one of my favorites in the past year. So obviously I like it, but I haven't gotten to try out the trading rules yet because you guys did that when I was out of town. So I'm going to have to get it to the table again.
Remember, you can win a copy of Star Tycoon potentially by heading to
tabletop.com. Sean may like it.
May. So that's what we need is a sci-fi Feld. That's what's missing. I don't think Feld's ever done a sci-fi game.
That awkward?
See, then? They're all historic. Mm-hmm. See, Sean already pointed out he didn't like historic games too. So next was last Wednesday. We did not record a podcast, so the three of us got together and decided to make a dent in the pile of obligation. This included trying out a couple of expansions for Robot Quest Arena. First was Kettle, which I actually broke out at the summoning. But we got played at the Walkerville event, but we didn't play it. So this was the first time we actually played our own copy of it. And we sat down and it's solid.
I thought it was interesting because it was in the box when we were at, well, I think Charlie Brown Windsor would know because wasn't he one of the people that was playing it at the event?
Yes, he was. Yeah.
And the cards for the expansion were in there, even if I don't think they were using the expansion robot. And I don't know that it didn't skew the deck. And like, maybe we need to remove the expansion cards, you know, particularly when doing a demo game or an intro game for folks.
So I don't think it does. We think that there may have been some extreme play happening with Joe's guys. Oh, they did play. So Yeah, it's the new, the pink robot's not actually new. I think you guys might have not used it last time, but it's not actually new. Yeah, so we think that there may have been some extreme play going on there at the table there, because when Mo and Jen and I played, we didn't see the sort of strange, expensive, explosion of points. Yes, there are going to be more points because of the way the shields work, but we'll talk more about that later.
Because I went over there and I kind of audited what they were doing, because they asked me for a rule clarification. I'm like, all of this looks like you're doing it right. You just managed to get like some wacky combo going. Congratulations, they're doing 20 points a turn. Like
the other one we tried out is we tried the Jaws expansion. This includes pits and switches. So there's now like a button. Sorry, I should say a button, not a switch. There's one button, which can make some of the tiles in the game flip over, and includes, and I didn't realize this was this exclusive, but the only two-sided tiles, terrain tiles, or battlefield tiles in the game. These were a lot of fun to play with. I really liked those new terrain tiles and what you could do with them. You also get a totally new type of card, which are upgrade cards, which you purchase and permanently stay in play, making your robot better for the rest of the game. That doesn't get shuffled in your deck. The other thing that I wanted to mention is each expansion does up the player count by one. So we can now play our copy of the game with six bots, which could be six players, but you could also do like three player teams or three players each controlling two bots. One of the things we haven't really dived into much in that game is playing teams, because there are rules for that. What we're going to probably do is over the next three episodes, counting tonight, so the next two episodes after this one, is review one new bot a week, starting with Kettle later tonight.
Yeah, I'm intrigued by the concept of the teams play. We'll have to give that a shot.
Yeah, I think we've got some great stuff here, and the and realistically, they aren't overpowered. Like the upgrades are interesting, and they are quirky, but they aren't like, oh my god, I have to have that.
Yes.
And the same I found with the defense. And again, Charlie Brown's, whether or not there were mistakes or not. And again, I don't know. I didn't visit their table as they were playing. But in our experience, it didn't really feel overpowered. And I didn't see the chance to really ratchet up the scores massively.
Now, they do warn right on their webpage that it does increase the game length. But we'll talk about that later. Next, Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay Elector Counts, a game we should all adore because it's Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. I'm not quite sure why they put the full fantasy roleplay name on that, but I think it's to point out the fact that it's not Age of Sigmar and it's set in the time period of the old world before the world ended and Chaos won the war. This is a Martin Wallace game, which is part of what made me want to dig into it more and make me think we missed something, because we played our initial play late at night after being exhausted at Origins in a dark corner. It wasn't dark, but like in a corner of the actual play area when we probably all should have went to bed. We decided to give another shot. So Deanna and I had been playing a couple two-player games. We got Sean to sit down and play three-player, and I've got to say it's definitely getting better. It's definitely been growing on me. Now, a big part of this is a game where you need to know the deck to play well. You need to know what the highest numbers are. There are specific rock, paper, scissor-like cards to counter other cards. And the reason you need to know all this is a drafting game. You're going to get a hand of cards, and you're going to pass half that hand to another player. So you know what those players have. So like you just know it's that kind of game, right? You have to know what cards are in play and what you've handed and what they can do with them and keep that counter card in your reserves and all that. It feels like a Martin Wallace game, right? Like there's a lot of strategy and tactics, but you got to know the cards to be able to employ them and to enjoy it. I adore the theme. I'm a huge Warhammer fanboy. I've said that many times. First role-playing game. Well, not my first role-playing game, but the first one I really dove into and ran myself. I love the Warhammer lore they've squeezed in. I love the well-known characters, and they went back, like they dug deep. Like one of the cards is Lumping Crooks Fighting Cooks, which is a halfling regiment of renown from the original Warhammer Fantasy Battle. A set I have been envious of for years. I've always wanted a copy of that particular set of miniatures. I dig it. I'm digging the game. But you need three people. Like it's one of those, if the three of us just keep playing it once a month, I think it'll just keep getting better every month. Every time we play, it'll be more cutthroat. It'll be more, oh, you got Balthazar Geltz. God dang it. I thought for sure I'd get him. I think that'll be part of the game, but it's not there yet.
I have a soft spot for Warhammer Fantasy. Like Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. I mean, because it was one of the first campaigns that I, long-term campaigns that I played in. I like the IP. I like the art. I like the look of the game. I will say the first time I played it, I was exhausted. It was late at night at Origins, and I didn't want to be playing the game, and I intensely disliked it, and I'm willing to float the idea that it was just because I was exhausted. And I have liked it better with each subsequent play, but still, like, it's a really low bar. So, it as you said, this is a game that rewards mastery. It feels almost like, you know, you have to be dedicated to playing this game and play it regularly, and then it would be a great game. Playing it now and then with several months in between and only having played it a few times, it's really meh. It's not doing it for me.
Yeah, the first, I'm with D on that first play. We were in a sour mood and that game just stood no chance. It is a fantastic experience in Fantasy Warplay, which is strange. I would not expect this to be Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay-esque. They have captured that very well. My second experience with the game was far and above a better game. It was enjoyable. I had fun playing it. Yep. Did I love it? Not yet, but it was an enjoyable game. And that was something that I wasn't expecting after our first experience. So that was great.
Yet again, proof that you should play games more than once before passing final judgment on them. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, you got to take that into consideration, right? Did I enjoy this game? Well, I played it with so-and-so. I don't know, because, like, right? Like, most first experience with Scythe. It's because it's a large part of the reason he didn't enjoy the game is because the people he was playing it with wanted to take it in a certain direction and play it as a certain style of war game in a certain very advertorial manner, and it made him not enjoy the game, right? So, yep.
No, I'm absolutely. Like,
that's why we got to play them 5 times with different people so we can figure out if they truly suck or not. I just feel bad that I don't like Elector Counts more than I do. I just feel guilty about it. I'm like, I feel Mo keeps going, but it's a good game. And I'm like, I could never play it again. And I would be okay with that.
It's a fine game. I think good is a bit strong. I think it's a really fine game. I think it nails that Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay experience in a really interesting way. It brings back all sorts of memories and feels.
Yep.
But it's a Wallace game. It's a Wallace game, and you really kind of gotta love Wallace games. And again, they're not bad, but they're not something I want to play all the time. So next up, while we're waiting for Mo, we played King's Coalition, which you guys got to play on the floor at Origins. I think your first play that I saw was during the new night, that first Wednesday night.
The media first look event,
where I got some shots of you playing that. What's interesting was, even though I had really only, you know, been there as a photographer taking pictures of you playing a game, I got a lot of it. Like it's a really easy to pick up game in that. While taking pictures of you playing that game, I felt like I was able to learn a little bit about the game. And that's something that's really nice to say about the game.
And that's not saying it's simplistic, because it's a nice, decent sort of strategy thing going on there. It's really enjoyable. It's super new hotness. It doesn't even exist yet. I guess you could get copies at Gen Con, but it's not going to be in stores until September. We're talking about King's Coalition, since you're back with us. So when we played with Sean, we played a basic game first, and there are some rules that are printed right on the cards that you just exempt for the basic go. And it's easy. It's easy to swap between the basic and the more advanced rules, and you don't have to take anything in or out of the deck. It's all just go. I like that. And then we played an advanced, and we have to say, going into it, Sean, weren't you like, I'm a little daunted by this. I don't think I want to play the advanced game.
It felt scary. The words on the thing, until you've actually sat down and paid attention enough, because you're going to play it, and as you're playing it, read the things, it feels like it's going to be way scarier than it actually is, when it turns out, oh no, this is really no big deal at all.
it just all makes sense once you're doing it, right? Absolutely. But at that time, it was like our third or fourth game of the night, and you're like, I'm not sure I have the brain power left for this. There was like a little look of panic
there. Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. Because there's a chunk of text on there. But it's
in the reference card. Yeah. Reference card's scary, too, because it lists them all at once. You're like, I gotta learn all these new rules.
Yeah, but it's really easy to play. So
yeah, I dig this one. Like it's a set collection game, right? That's all it is. It's mm-hmm. It could be considered gin rummy, right? The entire point of the game is you have start with a hand of cards, seven cards. Every round you're going to get a new card and you're going to discard one, which could be the one you got. Mm-hmm. You do that for six rounds and then you score your hand. The trick being you don't know exactly what you're going to score. You're always going to score from the total of your cards. You add them all up. You're going to score for sets of the same suit. And you're going to score for having numbers in order, but the rest of the goals in the game are randomized. And there's a significant stack of these.
And I really enjoy the way we reveal one more win condition, each round. And you have to adapt your hand as you play along. You have to go, well, oh, I can go with that one. Or no, we're just going to forget about that.
Yeah, that's it. I really dig that game. And yes, it was intimidating. To throw in, like, you read one of them and you're like, okay, so knights let you promote one of the other cards. Okay, I can see why I might want to do that now that I've seen the different things. That could help me complete a set. Like, okay, I got knights. Okay, what's clergy do? Oh, you just get 5 bonus points for your sets of clergy. Well, that's easy, right? And then once you get through them all, you're like, oh, that's not bad. And it's all right on the cards, which, you know, instead of having to grab the appendix and look up what each card does, it was very nice to have that information right there. I realize it's no longer language independent, but you know what? Zev's Play to Z Games is an American company and is not an international company shipping all over the world. At least at this point, maybe it'll get there. So I do appreciate having the English text on there.
Maybe they have language dependent versions that are released in French or in Spanish or whatever. I don't have a clue.
Last Sunday, fit in 3 games. Deanna was out of town. Sean came over to Brenda's. We played one with Genevieve and Brenda. The other ones were just with Brenda. The Stuff of Legend. We had our closest game yet. This is the Hidden Traitor one we've talked about in the past where you're playing Anima Toy is trying to save a boy who's been taken by the boogeyman in a sick and twisted world. This is not Stuff Fables. This is the adult version of Stuff Fables. This was one of the things in this game is you were trying to escape out of a portal. There's 4 on the board. They're numbered 1 through 7. It's randomized. So you don't know what numbers are up there. Your goal is to get out the biggest one. Well, at this point, we had searched all the portals in the game, but one. We had a 3, a 1, and a 6. We jumped out the 6. Flip up the last number. It was a flipping 7. Flipping 7. The only way we could have lost the game was for that to be a dang 7. So that was the closest game we have ever had. That was a win for the boogeyman, which was also a win for Brenda, who happened to be a traitor.
This game went much better than my first time through. I think it made more sense. It's still a tricky game. There's a lot going on. It's not an easy game by any means.
Yeah.
But it made more sense. And the discussions we were having about what to do felt more, you know, real. And what there wasn't, everyone had input and everyone had a say and valid input into what we may or may not do.
Yeah, the only thing in the game we kind of tossed out was the voting rules, which is a huge part of the game. But just so we don't have to every time, are we going to move and everyone puts their thumbs up or down? We were just like, if you don't want to do the action, say something and then we'll have a vote. Mm-hmm. And we just left it at that. And I think that really sped up the game and made it a little, I don't know. It was always awkward before because like, okay, I want to play this card. Can I play this card, everyone? Yeah, okay. Everyone's on board. Okay, good. We'll play it. And technically you're like supposed to go around the table. It was a little nice doing that. Now there was one rule I want to bring up because, you know, your first play of every game is going to be extreme. Sometimes on your third and fourth play, you discover this. So there was a thing. There is a card that has you swap your loyalty card with the one face down on the table. And when this came up, no one knew what that card was. So at the time, I double checked the rules. And in the rules, the only time it mentions you get to look at your loyalty card is at the start of the game. And then the cards in the game usually say swap cards with people, then you both look at them. So like Muddy the Waters, which is the card that most often muddies the waters by loyalty cards getting passed around, clearly states you get to look at the cards at the end. But the card that had us do the swap of the board did not. And to the fact that I even passed the rule book to Sean to verify that he was thinking the same thing I was. So what happened was the player swapped the position and then they didn't know if they were loyal or not, which was just weird and awkward. And you're kind of like, yes, they can later play a card to look at their loyalty, but they're kind of in limbo and it just felt off. So this is the one I mentioned earlier where I actually went on Board Game Geek and Michael from 3WS Games got back to me in less than 6 hours to say players are allowed to look at the loyalty cards anytime they want. There is open information to you, which makes sense, but it should have been in the book. It should have been clear. That line, players can look at their loyalty cards at any time, should have been in the rule book or should have been included on that card saying, once you've done the swap, look at your new card. Next up was a 3-player game of Mare Nostrum Empires. And what was most notable about that one was how quick it played. Because at this point, we had 3 players who had played each at least once before, so most of us more than that. And the smaller map was nice. We were able to drive in right away. Just kind of went over a quick rule overview and refresher. And we tried for the first time having all of the heroes and wonders up at the beginning. And I really like that. I definitely preferred playing that way, though I'm still glad we didn't have them all up for our first couple games.
Yeah, it's a really
we're gonna review this one. So more later.
Yeah, it's really interesting the difference in how the game plays between the slow reveal versus everything's up there all at once. It's the way you approach the game from your beginning turns is really different once you make that change.
So I was off on my own on the train for 4 days on my trip to go pick up Gwen from Halifax, and I got in plays of Aqualyn and Koale, and I also tried Gloomhaven Buttons and Bugs. Now, Aqualyn remains a favorite with Gwen, and I always enjoy playing it. She broke it out once she was on the train with me, and I was amused because when we were originally playing Aqualyn, we were playing it incorrectly. We were playing an extreme variant where anytime you slid a piece, you had to slide it as far as it could possibly go. And the rule is actually that you can slide it to wherever you prefer on the board. But she told me that she intentionally taught it to everyone in the extreme fashion while she was in Nova Scotia because she prefers it that way. And I was like, that's awful. You're teaching people the rules wrong. And then she's like, can we play it that way? And I was like, yeah, I'll play the extreme version with you. And then she's like, you won. All right, let's play the real rules. And then she's like, oh, you won again. Ah, let's play a different game. So we were playing Koale too, and it's solid, but like it doesn't make a great game for playing on the train because the pieces are very lightweight. The whole thing is very lightweight wood and it wants to bounce. And once you get those piles that are 3 or more pieces high, mm-hmm. like it gets dangerous. We were knocking things over and catching pieces and, it's travel friendly. It's very light and portable, but it is not train friendly.
Now, I think it's important to note you are playing the travel version of Koale too. Like the full game correct. Might have been better balanced because of the larger pieces. I don't know. I need to try Koale because the only play I had was one where the booth at, I think it was a GAMA. I can't remember. It was GAMA or Origins and the booth people were so busy, but I really wanted to try the game. So I picked up the rules and read them and then we played a game against each other. Mm-hmm. And following the Bellhop laws, we probably played extreme. So I think I need to give that one another shot.
Yeah, so this was my first time trying Gloomhaven Buttons and Bugs. And I mean, if you're not familiar, it's Gloomhaven shrunk down to little teeny tiny weeny travel size version. So I cracked it open for the first time on the train and there is a ton of stuff in that tiny box. It's like Mary Poppins' magical handbag. You're just taking it out and you're taking it out. And I was like, wow, this is pretty impressive, right? But what isn't in there is a proper rule book. The game only comes with a quick start guide that shows you how to set up and play the first scenario. It doesn't explain items or elements or any of the more advanced rules. Now, there's a QR code, and it is on the side of the box. There's like a QR code that says here for down, you know, get the rule book here and a playthrough. But I didn't realize that was the only way to get the rule book, right? And it's also on the, once you open up the guide, it's in there. There's a QR code to download a PDF version of the full rules. And yeah.
Yeah, I understand this, like, especially for Gloomhaven, seeing as our most popular YouTube video of all time is Sean and I talking about the FAQ for Gloomhaven for over 2 hours. So I get them wanting to have a digital rulebook that they can update whenever they need to, but I hate online-only rulebooks.
Yeah, as of right now, I have not downloaded or looked at the PDF. I don't know how massive it is, but I can see that it would be problematic to fit in this little tiny box, right? But it just, they're touting it as a travel size game, and I'm traveling and I don't have, you know, like a big tablet or my home PC to read a PDF rule book on. I've got a cell phone and we're out in the boonies with no cell access and no way to download anything. And I mean, I think that's not that uncommon to not have cell access when traveling. So a travel game where the rules are not in the box to me is a flaw, and it made me grumpy. And then my next complaint was that we had this little teeny shrunken down version of Gloomhaven, and I was told that it was designed to be played on an airplane tray, and it did not fit on our train table tray. Like, how big are airplane trays? I haven't been on an airplane in a while, but I'm like, I always thought, you know, the train trays and airplane trays are about the same. So I'm like, what airline are you riding on? What size is an airplane tray? Because for Gwen and I to play it, and basically I GM'd it and she played, right? I had to sit next to her on the train, and we played over two train trays, and she was holding on to a bunch of cards that the layout actually showed we should have had laid down because we just didn't have enough space for it. And yeah, so I'm like, I don't know. And then there's the fact that the whole game is very fiddly. It's lots of very small components, and they didn't want to stay where I placed them. As the train's bumping along, and I get it. If you're on an airplane, unless there's serious turbulence, it's probably less bumpy. But it just, it wasn't working on the train. It was pretty awful. Like, it felt perilous. I was certain we were going to lose pieces at any moment. So we quit after the first scenario. But I couldn't have gone further because we didn't have the rules for anything further.
Yeah, interestingly, they actually have I'm looking at the rules for Buttons and Bugs right now, and they didn't format it in a normal full page, you know, 8.5 by 11 size. It's actually small pages. Now, there are like 42 pages, but they are definitely smaller sized for screen, like small screens. So it's designed. Yeah. So if you turn your phone into landscape mode, they should actually be a little more readable and useful that way. So in their defense, they did think about it.
If I had caught it ahead of time and downloaded it, I probably would have felt a lot less grumpy about it.
We wrapped up the week with some more Star Tycoons, but we're reviewing that in a second. And we already kind of talked about that. So still digging it.
Mare Nostrum is the name the Romans gave the Mediterranean Sea, which meant our sea in Latin. Prove the Romans wrong in Mare Nostrum Empires, an empire-building game featuring that sea and various historic empires that existed on its borders in an anachronistic battle for dominance.
Mare Nostrum Empires was designed by Serge Lagat and features artwork from Jean-Marie Minguez. While this one's new to us, it was originally published back in 2016 by Academy Games, who we do have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy. Game still in print and supported and can be found at most online game stores and probably your friendly local game store.
This unique empire building folk on a map game scales very well, playing from 3 to 5 players. Games will run 1.5 to 2+ hours, which they do get much quicker once you have a group that all know how to play.
As for weight, this mashup of Euro-style board game and war game is a medium to a bit heavy, perhaps more towards heavy as a board game, while lighter than many heavy war games.
Extend your influence into new provinces, establish trade caravans and markets, found new cities and temples, recruit heroes and create wonders, all with the goal of meeting one of 4 victory conditions. Win by building the pyramids, by having a mix of 5 heroes and or wonders, by controlling 4 capitals and or legendary cities, or being the top in trade, culture, and military. All of this is driven by a unique economy where you pay for things through sets of unique commodities or a set of coins.
Physically, Mare Nostrum comes in a standard square board game box, fits great in italics, and features a ton of cardboard and plastic components. There's a large main board, and then there are 2 sideboards. And you sometimes place these on top of the main board to shrink the map down for lower player counts. And I lack the words to describe how much I love the way the board scales. It's really clever. I was quite geeked out about this when we first discovered it. The game comes with tokens for 13 different commodities, plus plastic military units in 5 player colors, building tokens, 2 different sets of custom dice, 1 for land battles and 1 for sea battles, tiles for the various wonders, player screens, and more.
All of this is stored in a rather good plastic box insert, which has done a surprisingly good job of keeping things sorted, especially the different units and commodity tokens. There's even room for expansion content, but we haven't gotten to that yet.
I especially like how the materials used and the shape of things all mean something. Cities and temples are square. Military units are triangles. Markets and caravans are round. All of this coincides with the markings on the tracks on the board that track those various things, your different control areas. They're also color-coded as well. And as a bonus, the plastic units are actually unique. At least the Legion units are unique for each army.
Yeah, that shape and color thing makes things so easy to track and almost intuitive, right? All right, with that, let's get into an overview of play. Now, this is an empire-building war game from a company known for their historical war games. So we are going to give you an overview of play. Just know there are a lot of little details and exceptions, and we will probably be skipping over.
At the start of the game, each empire controls three provinces on the map and starts with some stuff in play: markets, cities, temples, caravans, and military units. This is all very asymmetric, and the empires available each game is based on the player count.
Now, each round in Mare Nostrum starts with a collect resources phase. Here, players collect commodities and coins based on the buildings they have in their controlled provinces, with markets and temples doubling the production for the provinces they are in.
Next is the trade resources phase. Here, the trade leader decides how many commodities players will trade that round. For each trade, a player takes one commodity token from those their opponents have up for trade. And like, you just lay them out on the table and then you pick from them. And then the player whose token was taken gets to choose one from another player, and so on until all the trades are complete.
Collecting coins and or different sets of commodities is very important, as the next phase is the build phase. Everything you build in Mare Nostrum costs coins or sets of different commodity tokens. Basic things in the game costs a set of three. This includes cities, caravans, military units, and provincial control markers, while temples and markets cost six.
Now, during the build phase, you can also recruit a hero or build a wonder. These are represented by tiles, and each gives the owning player some form of rather powerful special ability, and may also advance them up one or more of the game's three tracks. One of the ways to win the game is to hire build your fifth of these tiles. Now, the cost to build these starts at 7, but escalates for every one you have up to a total of 10.
The last thing you can build is the pyramids. The pyramids cost 12, and they win you the game instantly as soon as they are built. The order players build in is determined by the player at the top of the culture track. As players build things, they should be constantly adjusting their positions on the game's three tracks.
Next is the move and battle phase. There are three unit types in Mare Nostrum Empires: triremes, legions, and fortresses. The military leader decides who acts first each battle phase, with the active player first moving any triremes and fighting any naval battles, and then moving any legions. Fortresses are defensive and cannot be moved.
Now, battles are pretty simple, but there is a bit of war game roots here. It's something you don't usually see in board games, where you're going to divide. You are going to roll one custom die for each unit in a battle. You total the dice and divide them by five, rounded down. This is the amount of units you defeat. Rolls are simultaneous for both sides. Remember to update the military track as units are removed from the board during battles.
After a battle, if there are still units from more than one side left, that province remains at war. However, if the defenders win, nothing changes, but if a conqueror wins, they have a number of options like pillaging when building, occupying buildings, or trying to take provincial control. If a player manages to occupy a total of four capitals or legendary cities, they win the game.
At the end of each round is a claim leadership phase. Here you see which empires are the highest on the three tracks: trade, culture, and military. If a single player is at the top of all three tracks, they win the game.
Assuming no one's won, you start another round. Generate resources, trade with each other, build stuff, and battle until one of the four victory conditions are met. Note, due to this, the game length can really vary in Mare Nostrum Empires, because there's no time limit. You never just get to the end. There's no set number of turns. Someone is going to have to claim one of those four goals. Now, as you may or may not know, Deanna is a longtime classics fan with a degree, and she's the one that convinced us to check this game out. Though at the time, we thought it was going to be a little more historic than it is. So that is one thing to be aware of. If you are a historic war gamer, Don't expect that here. This is not that. This is an anachronistic war game as it features empires from different time periods, as well as fantasy elements, including gods and heroes that you can recruit.
I have to admit, I took a really quick cursory glance at this. I saw Mare Nostrum, Ancient Greek. I went, that's it. I want that one. I knew Academy Games makes cool historic games, and I was like, that's it. I need it. This is not a historical game. Hammurabi did not live in the same time period as Cleopatra. We're talking like 1,700 years apart. Castor and Pollux aren't historical characters. This is not a game that's going to be teaching anyone history. It's like it takes all the classical Civ stuff from like a 2,000 year period, puts it in a blender, a little bit of myth, pinch your Homer's epics. Oh, and let's toss in the seven wonders of the ancient world. I will say, I appreciate that by throwing in figures like Circe and Antigone, they were able to include a number of female characters in the heroes deck. So that's cool. And I did love the game overall. It just wasn't quite what I was expecting when we first jumped in.
Now, I have to say, as someone who isn't a huge fan of historical games, this actually turned out to be a bonus because I was hesitant. This game scared me some. But as we got into it, because of the high level of play and the lack of historical accuracy and intimidation of, you know, needing to know historical facts, it made for a much easier play.
Now, the next thing I think is important to know about this game is, while it is a war game, it is definitely a war game, actually ranked in the top 100 war games of all time on Board Game Geek. This is a different type of war game. This has a very strong Euro board game feel, mainly due to the fact that everything you buy in this game is paid for in sets of commodities or coins. And that's what really makes this game stand out as something unique and different.
Yeah, in fact, this is kind of only a war game if you choose to play it that way. While it's wise not to ignore military entirely, it is not a requirement, depending on the aggressiveness of the other players at the table.
And honestly, at least in the games I played, focusing solely on military to the exclusion of all else doesn't get you very far. For one thing, you don't have all that very many troop pieces available to build. Like, you have a very limited number of plastic pieces. In at least two games that I played, I was like, I still have resources. I could build more, but I now have all my pieces on the table. Okay, I got to find something else to do with myself here.
And that's the other thing. This is an empire building game. This is not a conquest game. You cannot possibly take over the entire map. It just cannot be done with the number of components in this game. That is not what this game is about. Now, the other thing to note, we already kind of mentioned this isn't a historical accuracy, but it's also not trying to simulate anything. This is a high level abstract empire build. Like, you only have three unit types, right? You have boats, you have ground troops, and you have a defense piece. That's it, right? And we're not getting into minutia and different types of legions and legionnaires and weapons and shields. Now, there are differences between the empires, and that is represented by where they start and their starting resources, as well as what hero they start with. So the actual differences aren't the unit types, it's the heroes. Like Caesar, the Roman legions, the Caesar hero makes their legions more powerful in attacking, whereas the Greeks get a bonus on defense. But then when we get into like the Persians, their bonus has to do with purchasing things. Now, the heroes you hire can modify combat as well, and pretty much every other part of the game. And you can go with different types of strategies, but this is no way any form of simulation. So if that's what you're looking for, look elsewhere.
Yeah, and I would say that due to the starting locations and starting heroes, there are indications as to which path you might want to strongly consider going in, but they aren't requirements or necessities, and you could just grab all the heroes that take you down a completely different path if you would like.
Now, what heroes and wonders you buy does make a big impact in the game. When learning the game, it's suggested you only start with so many out at once. I think it's five. I don't remember off the top of my head. And then once someone purchases one, you reveal a new one. So you have a little subset of the wonders and heroes to buy from. Now, once you know the game, they strongly recommend you put them all out at once. And I've got to say, we did that learning curve. I played three games where we played it the one way and then dove into having them all up. And that, I can totally see, would have been overwhelming. It would have been too many choices. I wouldn't know what to do in my first games, but I loved having that available for experienced players where you can start, like, all the strategies are now open to you. You can start building fortresses cheap and building units cheap, or you can fly up the tracks by taking the heroes like Hercules.
Yeah, and as much as I was previously picking apart how this is not a historically accurate game, if you accept this all as vaguely classical Civ fantasy setting, the theming is great. The abilities of the characters and the buildings all make sense, and they tie in well with who or what they are.
Yeah, it's interesting as the limited heroes and wonders really help narrow your options for beginners. Mm-hmm. but it also sets up fights over these limited options, mm-hmm. while the full list allows player to each pick their own path, which may conflict with the path chosen by others, but it doesn't limit those options early in the game the way that intro setup does.
So I will say someone will buy that hero or monument you want just before you get to go. And then you get to yell at the trade minister for letting them build first. Now, the most brilliant thing in this entire game, and this is the highlight, this is the thing that it, like the Eurogamers need to pay attention, is that commodity system. And it's better than it sounds, right? It's not that you just like mass up these resources and hold them between turns until you've got enough different types. The way the map is designed, each different empire has access to different commodities. Now, there's some overlap there, but even when playing with five players, you're going to have something no one else can make. And there's no way, as I mentioned earlier, to conquer the entire map. So there's no way one player can possibly generate every commodity in the game. It just can't happen. The only way to do it is to expand, to build markets, and then to trade, which leads to a huge amount of player interaction. And unlike many war games, that interaction isn't just fighting each other in territory control. It's not necessarily conflict. And no, you can't trade except during that trade phase. So it's not like you're just like, hey, give me one of those, I'll give you one of these. The game doesn't work that way. Now, there are rules where you can negotiate. You are welcome to make deals and promises and say, hey, next trade phase, I'll make sure to put two of those out if you take them. But none of that's binding.
There are so many neat things going on in this game. And I really like the way the trade phase plays out. Like, you aren't stuck with Catan-style trading where favoritism or sheer stubbornness can wildly sway a game. You have to trade. The number of goods decided on for that round by the trade minister, you have to put that number out. You can't just pass and decide not to trade. And you can't stockpile because you're limited in how many resources you can have left at the end of the turn. And also, when you are collecting sets, you're not collecting like five of a kind. You need five different ones. You know, I love all of that.
Yeah, no, it's really interesting. And the fact that your resources are hidden, which we haven't even talked about yet, are hidden behind a screen. So unless someone's paying really close attention, they aren't going to be aware that you may have eight different ones and then a bunch of duplicates, and trading may get you up to the 10 or the 12 that wins the game for you because it's hidden information except for what's actually out being traded.
Yeah, and the other thing, like you mentioned, resources carrying over, they don't. Unless you build a specific wonder, you don't get to carry over anything except for a couple coins. And coins and resources, to make it clear, you can pay a full set of coins. But if you want to build the pyramid, you need 12 coins. So there you're collecting one of the same thing. Coins are a little different, but the other commodities you need different. And you don't get to carry it over. You're going to spend everything, which actually encourages people to build and put more units on the map and do things, which I also appreciate. Now, the other thing I love about this game is that whole four victory condition thing. That is just brilliant, honestly. Like, I want more games with four completely different ways to win. And this isn't a coin game where each player has their own way to win. These are options available to all players. One is a military victory. The rest aren't. They're based on being higher on tracks or having units in play or collecting enough different resources to purchase heroes. The last three games I played were all won due to a different condition, and that is awesome. The combination of the commodity rules and the four victory conditions mean you really need to watch your opponents. It's often the player you least expect who suddenly is one action away from winning. And you get that whole catching it like, oh, watch out. That person's one away. We need to stop them while you're not paying attention to me because I'm also one away.
Yeah. Okay. Like I said, there are so many things about this game I love. I love the way the map scales. I love that it's classical Civ theming. I love the trading mechanics, right? But what really sold it for me is the fact that there are four different ways to win. There's no one true way that you have to play the game.
What's really interesting to me is that not only are there multiple paths to winning, but the determination of who might win is often determined by whoever is the leader in a track. For instance, in our last game, I was actually sitting quietly to myself with two different ways to win. But the minister gave Mo the first option to build, and I thought for sure I had lost. I thought Mo was going to make the build that would have won him the game. And I sat quietly while everyone else had their turns and everyone else built everything until I finally was relieved enough to realize that, oh no, I've won the game. But nobody else, but I had to sit there quietly twiddling my thumbs, waiting in case someone else was going to get a victory condition to win the game until it was my turn. And I could actually win at the time.
In that same game, the turn before, I could have won by military victory if the dice had been on my side. If I had committed one more troop, I should have vacated my home province to send in one more troop. And I think I would have won the game that way.
Yeah, I find our games have always felt relatively close. Like, it's not a huge runaway leader thing, you know?
Yeah. So personally, with Mare Nostrum, I didn't really have any interest in this game and didn't really know much about it until we cracked it open for the first time. And I read the rules, and it was the rules that sold me right away. I was just like, this is brilliant. This is really neat. This is the four ways to win. And the sets of commodity thing, like, until you see it in play, it's just so well done. I was completely sold by reading the rule book. And then when we sat down to play, I was like, yep. And everyone got it. Like, our first game, we had everyone from our youngest child to Dee's mom at the table. We had a range of players with different experience levels and age, and everyone got it. They got it well. And by the end of the game, everyone knew what was going on. That said, the first game's still going to be rough. There's a bit to learn here. I just love the way this game flows, how simple the three phases are, while still having a ton of valid decision points. Like, there's no one right way to play. And due to the various victory conditions, there are lots of valid strategies. The game's also rather tactical, because you're going to have to adjust your play based on what the other players are doing. And it's not just because someone built your wonder. It's because, wow, they're rushing ahead. And if I don't stop them, they're going to be able to get this victory condition. Meanwhile, I'm busy with something else. And I love the end game. When you know everyone's kind of close, and now your focus shifts from, well, I need to try to do the thing so I can win, but I also have to stop Sean because I'm certain he has enough commodities back there. I love that end game.
Yeah, admit it. You're glad I talked you into getting this one.
Yeah, no, totally.
Yeah, I will admit, I was not eager when this game was first laid out in front of me. And I will say that you have to go in understanding that your first play of this game is probably going to be pretty rough. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to miss things. But once you fight through that and experience the full game, there is a really solid game here. And the breadth of victory options is a great tool to help craft the game to your style, especially once you have all those legends and wonders to choose from the beginning.
So Mare Nostrum is not a historical war game or a simulation anyway. It's a fanciful take on multiple empires over different time periods in the same geographical location. It also takes a lot of liberties with its heroes and gods. If you're looking for your meaty hex encounter war game, or to learn something about the ancients other than some names, or a true historical war game, you are going to have to look elsewhere.
But if you know what you're getting into, this is fun. I mean, I loved it. And even sitting here doing this review, I'm like, can we go play it again right now? So it's up there for me.
And if you're scared of the meaty hex encounter games, don't worry. Yeah. This isn't that. Feel free to enjoy a fun empire building game that doesn't have the terror of some of the hex encounter games.
Plus, if you don't like recreating actual battles and sometimes problematic periods of history, this lets you play around in that sandbox without having to recreate anything actually historic. Like, it's a good abstract look at battles around the Mediterranean without getting into the minutiae.
The semi-abstract nature, the high-level play is what really allowed this game to win me over. And once I got past the learning curve, to really enjoy the play of it.
Now, I've already kind of called it out a few times, but the fun thing here to me is for people who dig economic Euro games that are about collecting sets of commodities and using them to build something, and that engine building and empire building, you should check this game out. Don't be scared by the fact it's a war game. Don't be scared that it comes from Academy Games, who are known for, like, classroom games that have educational rule books with them. Other thing, though, to watch, though, is if you dig multiplayer solitaire, if you are that Euro player who wants to do their own thing and not be interfered with and, you know, score the most points and outdo yourself, there's a lot of player interaction in this game, and some of it will be backstabby. And there will be fighting. This is a war game, so you might want to stay away from it if that's the type of Euro you're looking for.
Personally, I think Mare Nostrum Empire is a fantastic Waro, a mashup of war game and Euro game that blends the two perfectly and keeps me wanting to come back for more. And at some point, I need to win a game using each victory condition. So far, I've got the pyramids and the Hero Wonder Wings covered.
Oh, I like that idea. We should make a little bingo card and put it in the box and collect all win conditions.
Well, that's it for our look at Mare Nostrum Empires. Now, in this review, we use terms like Euro, Euro game, war game, and Waro. And as time goes on, and board games continue to change and evolve and I would say improve, I start to wonder how useful these terms are anymore. We're seeing more and more overlap between styles of games, and it's no longer the old Ameritrash versus Euro game anymore. To just say hobby board game means something in between those two. Genre mashing is just part of good game design anymore, and I'm all here for it. Though people do like to put things into buckets, so I guess maybe it's just time for some new buckets, like that term Wuro. I do dig that
one. What would you put in the Wuro bucket? What's a game you dig that is a mashup of Euro-style board game and war game? It's a genre we've been enjoying more than I thought we might, and we would love to hear about other games that we should check out.
They say an army survives on its stomach. Well, the Bellhop team survives on coffee, and you can help support us and caffeinate us by buying us a coffee at tabletopbellhop.com/coffee. Capitalism in space! That's the theme of Star Tycoon, a tableau-building economic game from Warp Core Games and Good Games Publishing, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy.
This sci-fi-themed economic game comes from the design team of Peter and Alkira Sanderson, and features artwork from Michael Dickinson. Plays 1 to 4 players, though technically the game includes components to play up to 6, but the rulebook actually says we don't recommend it and hasn't been playtested, so to each your own, maybe you'll enjoy it. Games take over an hour, but get quicker the more you get to know the game and the cards.
The game is listed for ages 14+, but we could see some younger players enjoying it, and it's a good, solid, medium-weight game that has some mechanics that will be familiar to players of other card-based engine builders like, say, Splendor.
Gameplay involves trying to become the best galactic corporation by conquering planets, building developments on those planets, playing the market, and reaching out to brands.
Get a look at the component quality in this game, which includes a very useful resource tray in our Star Tycoon unboxing video on YouTube.
The component quality here is solid. There are 3 types of commodities, and these are differentiated by different shaped, thick cardboard tokens. The card quality is good, with somewhat small but good iconography, and the rulebook is very well written. Well, the box insert actually works quite well to keep everything separated. And as Mo just noted, the resource tray is great. It's great for putting it away, and it's great for popping it out, putting it on the table, and passing it around as you're playing.
Well, now that you know what you get, let's dive into an overview of play.
So to the start of the game of Star Tycoon, every player is dealt a random home planet, an Omniforge, which goes on that home planet. This gives you a starting production of 2 different resources and a set of 3 corporations. Players choose one of those corporations to play, and that corporation gives you your starting resources and an asymmetric in-game ability.
Star Tycoon is played out over 4 rounds. Each round is broken into 3 cycles, and in each cycle, each player will take 1 turn, and each turn they get 3 actions. Got it? All right. Thankfully, this is simpler than it sounds. And the Galactic Market board has a tracker, so you don't lose track of where you are. At the end of the 4th round, the player with the most points wins.
The majority of points will come from players adding things to their tableau that match the requirements on their corporation and planet cards. Each corporation and planet card clearly lists its requirements and the points that you will get for filling those requirements. Points can also be collected by reaching out to brands, some development cards, and for collecting communication arrays. There is also a randomly picked bonus tile in play each game that awards bonus points for collecting sets of something, plans, planets, endgame resources, etc.
Every round but the first starts with an event. For the most part, these are positive and end up giving players extra resources or actions, though some do really mess with the galactic market. After the event is resolved, everyone collects resources in the production phase, which is as simple as looking at your tableau and grabbing 1 resource for each symbol found in their blue production boxes. First turn of the game, this will just be the player's Omniforge, but that'll grow.
Next, we get to the player's turns. Each player will get 3 of these before the next round, and on each turn, they get to do 3 actions in any order. Players can purchase cards, which includes planets, and 3 ranks of development cards. You can only purchase cards from a full row, which can lead to some hard decisions. New planets are added to your tableau, whereas developments must be added to a planet that you already have in play. To purchase a card, you must discard resources equal to its cost. You can also reach out to a brand with a purchase action. Brands provide endgame scoring for collecting multiple developments from that brand.
Now, each planet lists the requirements to score it at the end of the game, which could include the developments from specific brands or specific resources that need to be produced there. Each development lists what it does for you, with the majority having a blue production box that will generate resources at the start of each round. Other developments provide points, smuggling opportunities, and some even allow you to steal resources from other players.
Often you'll find you don't have the resources you want to be able to buy the cards you need, so that's where the trade action comes in. Star Tycoon includes a market board that tracks the current prices of each of the game's resources, and the market fluctuates as you buy and sell goods. Each trade action does allow you two transactions.
Another way to get resources during your turn is to run your Omniforge. It's randomly determined which one you get, and each Omniforge is unique and produces a different set of two resources. Now, while running your Omniforge sounds like a bit of a wasted action, I found I ended up doing it quite a bit, as it can be very useful at times.
Now, if you can't afford a card now, but know you can later, you can always reserve a card. This has to come from a full row, and each player can hold one reserved card at a time. Any card in reserve can be played during a future purchase action.
Now, some developments include smuggle action spots. When you choose to take the smuggle action, you can activate any two such smuggle actions in play. What's interesting is these can be yours, the cards you built, they can be another player's, or they can be cards face up in the market, which I think is kind of fascinating. Now, if you do use an opponent's card, you have to bribe them with one energy. This can be a great way to gain or sell goods without having to worry about the current market price.
If you don't like the cards on display, you can take the refresh action and wipe the full row and replace it with new cards. This is not an action that we found people taking very often, but one that can be very useful if you're looking for a specific planet type, resource, or brand.
There's one more thing you can do that doesn't cost you one of your action, and that is to take out a loan. This gets you 5 energy, but you have to pay back 1 energy each production phase, or the bank confiscates your Omniforge production for the round. You can pay back a loan at any time by paying 5 energy, or if you can afford the hit, keep it for -5 points at the end of the game.
At the end of each round, after each player has taken 3 sets of 3 actions, there's a discard phase. Players must discard down to 7, but can go lower, and for each token discarded, the market value of that resource drops by 1. At the end of the fourth round, players add up their scores, and the player with the highest score wins.
While you're doing all of this, be aware that each player's corporation gives them a special, powerful, rule-breaking ability. These seem rather OP until you realize they are all rather OP, so they balance out. These include things like being able to buy from non-full rows, being able to run anyone's Omniforge, not just your own, reserving an extra card, and getting a free reserved action each round, and more.
In addition to these basic rules, the game also includes a solo mode. A solo game spans 3 plays, with each game having a unique victory condition based on your starting Omniforge's number. If you win a game, you start the next game with a new homeworld, Omniforge, and company, and you will end up with a new goal. If you lose any of the 3 games, you need to start over and try again.
Finally, there are optional rules that allow for open trading and negotiation between players during the game. I personally found the game really opened up when using this, and I recommend you include these rules after your first couple of plays.
Well, that all sounds way more complicated than Star Tycoon actually is. This is a very smooth and elegant engine builder with a strong economic element. Combine that with this sci-fi theme, and the actions make sense. The gameplay is logical. It just makes sense.
Yeah, this one's oddly thematic with its tongue-in-cheek look at capitalism. I think there's some social commentary going on here. You are not playing the good guys here, and I adore things like the fact that you reach out to Prans for sponsorship. It just amuses me.
Yes, the theming, the fact that brand sponsorship is one of your angles for Engor's game scoring, that amused me vastly. From the very first game, when I took my 3 corporations and looked at them, I went, okay, this is clearly I can play a Ferengi, and they do smuggling type things. I'm like, I'm so amused by the card art and the names and the like, all of that. The I don't know, sarcastic sense of humor that's there. I dig it.
Yeah, perhaps sadly, late stage capitalism games are powerful statements of where we are and where we're headed in Western countries, at least.
I want to highlight a Star Tycoon to me is that stock market, right? It's a stock market game. but it's a super easy to use, basic, that it just works market. Right. When we were first learning this game and we agreed to this, I expected the market to be a major part of the game. I thought that you were going to be manipulating markets. And I'm like, no, like the market matters. It's important. It does have impact. And you know, having a price tank when you need to sell and when you need money sucks. And sometimes when commodity prices go up, you're going to have to look for other options. But it's really like a simple market, right? The math is simple. It's just adding and subtracting. The market's easy to manipulate the way you want. Like, I was expecting Planet Steam, which is one of the heaviest market games I've ever played. And this is more on the level of, say, The Exchange. And to me, that's a good thing.
Yeah, compared to when you had read the rules and explained it as we were setting out for our first game, I just thought the market was going to be more swaying from one side to the other. No, that did. I find that the market just kept equaling out. And there are also event cards that make it swap from one side to the other, yeah, or equal out in the center. So just the market never did what I expected it to do, and also was more centralized than I expected it to be.
Now, another aspect I really appreciate is the design work that went into the components and graphics. The iconography is clear, but more important than that, the various types of commodities are differed by shape, which I love. You can clearly tell the difference between energy, which is what you use to buy things and what you get when you sell things, resources, the things you're buying and selling, and illicit goods, which are a kind of special type of resource with its own rules. The iconography on the cards matches as well. So it's very clear when, you know, you're talking about just resources or you're talking about energy. That said, I do have my usual complaint that things could be bigger, especially the cost to buy cards. I would like to be a little larger. The art could be a little smaller, a little more covered up, especially in regards to the cost. The bottoms, I find very clear. Just that cost on the side of the card, which was a little bigger.
I think the only thing I struggled with, and it depended on where I was seated at the table, was making out like there's like almost an element to each planet. And those little elements, some of them look pretty similar, and they could just be a little bit larger. That was honestly my only complaint, because overall the iconography was very easy to understand.
Yeah, I think one somewhat less thematic aspect is that the identity of the resources themselves, aside from the ships, most people will just refer to them by color, even with the fact that they are very clear iconography. I don't think this takes away from the game, but it does pull you out of the theme some when you're asking for blue and green tokens.
Yeah, another thing I found is people just call them whatever they think they look like, and different people have different names for the different tokens. It's not to say the green one, but some people are like, give me the crystal, or give me the ice, or I would like some water, even though they're all talking about the same commodity. Now, one aspect of the game that may turn some players off is the fact there are some nasty take that cards. Now, most of these are cards you can purchase with illicit goods, sticking to that theming, that let you steal resources from other players. In addition to this, this is a game where players will draft the cards you want, and the value of goods you want to buy or perhaps sell will change just before it's your turn to go to the market. While this does lead to a high amount of player interaction, people who don't like the negative interactions may be turned off by that part of the game.
It's not really backstabby, though. Like, there's just that one, the cards that you purchase with the illicit goods that allow you to take one good from someone at the table. That's the one that comes up the most often. And I mean, really stealing that one good doesn't feel, I don't know, it doesn't feel huge.
Yeah, more so than the take that cards, to me, it's the haste drafting that's a major aspect of this game. It's open knowledge what everyone is trying to get. So if you can take something that won't hurt you, but will hurt another person's score, it's just a wise choice to make.
Now, another problem with this game, potential problem, is AP, analysis paralysis. When looking to purchase a card, you've got 12 choices. You've got 3 planets and 9 developments to choose from at different levels. Then you could reach out to brands. And then each of these developments shows what it produces, if it produces points, and what brand it represents. You could also wipe these if you don't like anything. And there's the ability to reserve cards. Then add this to the fact of getting the right resources can be hard. And figuring out how you might be able to afford that level 3 development instead of that level 2 becomes a puzzle, honestly. And sometimes they take a while to figure out. Of all the games we played, honestly, I would say in the last year, this is the game we've seen the most analysis paralysis of. And that's coming from players who are usually quick on their feet.
Yeah, Mo called me out for having terrible AP during this game, and I was actually surprised. And you have to understand that I do like to really analyze my moves, and I have this little guilt meter that's usually running that's going, okay, don't take too long on your turn. But my guilt meter wasn't running. I was so engrossed in the game, I simply did not even notice that I was having terrible AP, like really terrible AP. So I really love the game. I got so entirely engrossed in it, I didn't even realize I was taking 5 minutes to figure out my turn.
Yeah, as someone who tends to make snap decisions and not fully evaluate my choices and not, you know, delve deep and deep and, you know, figure out math turns and turns ahead. But the market changes dramatically, even in a 3-player game. Mm-hmm. So planning in advance is often futile and can even work against you, meaning that all your thinking is likely going to take place on or just before your turn, which just makes it that much worse.
Yeah, like really, if you really want to be the good player and plan ahead, you need to plan contingencies. I'm going to do this unless the market changes. Then I'll do this unless that card gets bought. Then I'll do this. It's pretty much the only way to plan ahead. And Dan earlier said that the market doesn't always affect the game as much. Well, she didn't play in our last game. So we definitely saw the market get a little wider and not staying near the middle nearly as much. Though we still haven't seen really the far extremes. And Dia, it wasn't just you with the AP. Now, what I got to say is that puzzle aspect that drives the AP, Deanna kind of said it without saying it there, was that's the part I enjoy the most about this game is figuring out that puzzle, right? I get that same feeling from Lost Ruins of Arnak, right? How do I eke out enough resources to buy that thing, that just a little bit more expensive game? Yeah, I could go buy this, but, you know, if I just had 2 more energy, I could instead buy this. How do I get that 2 energy and then kind of backtracking it? Okay, if I trade and I do this and I use my Omniforge and I use my Omniforge to go smuggle this thing that lets me get this thing. And oh, wait a minute, if I do it this way instead, I can get that planet and fill it this turn because it only needs 2 spots. How can I afford all 3 of those? Right? That's what keeps me coming back for more. And that's what engages me about Star Tycoon.
Hang on. That's exactly it.
Yeah, one thing players should keep an eye out for that can add to the AP problem, especially in early games, in your first few games, is the difference between actions and turns and rounds. Mistaking a round for a turn hurt me when I was choosing my corporation last game, and it's an easy enough mistake to make until you're familiar with the different levels of play in the game.
Yeah, it's a little annoying, right? 4 rounds, and each round players are going to get 3 turns, and each turn they're going to get 3 actions. That is not always easy to track, and the difference between a turn and an action and a round is important. Some of the more powerful abilities in game can only be activated once per round, and you'll forget because you've already had your turn and it's come back around to you again, so you think it's your turn. No, we're still in the same round. It's your second turn of round 1. Mm-hmm. Now, another thing that keeps me coming back to this game is the variety, right? There are 6 starting planets and 12 corporations, 6 different Omniforges, and 6 different endgame bonus tiles. I don't know how many events there are. I just know we haven't seen all of them. And then, of course, it's a card game with 4 decks, right? The amount of variability here is huge. Every game we played of Star Tycoon has felt unique and different. One game, it's a race for planets. Everyone's buying a planet every turn. Everyone's making sure they have red tokens available at the start of their turn so they can draft first. Next, it's everyone reaching out to the brands. There's literally a rule in the game where you can only reach out to one brand at once, which kind of shows you per turn, which kind of shows you how powerful they can be and how much points they can generate. Well, one game, people are reaching out in turn 1, trying to get brands early and then crafting what they're building next. Then there's that tight game where, like, no one has enough resources and the market's running high. Everything's to the right of the middle and no one can afford anything. And your tableaus are much smaller. It's so fascinating to see the game play so differently, where it's still the same game, right? We're not playing different difficulty levels. We're not changing anything. It's just the randomness of the cards.
Yeah, those end game bonus tiles really changed what your goals were, much more so than end game bonus tiles in some other games out there. I don't know how else to say that. Like, that really changed the flavor of each game that we played. Your corporation, other things that you choose also changes it, but I found those end game tiles were what really swapped it up.
Yeah, for me, I was finding it was the corporation. And making that choice and especially in combination with that end game tile, mm-hmm. where you're like, okay, so we're collecting that. Well, this planet will give me this, but this planet will give me this. Which do I want to go? And you really are setting yourself off on a path when you pick that corporation to go with.
So overall, I think it's pretty clear from what we've said so far. We're all really digging Star Tycoon. I don't know if it's there yet because this just came out, right? I'm worried this is going to be a hidden gem. I honestly think it's a hidden gem because I don't hear or see a lot of people talking about it. But then looking at a lot of people, Gen Con Hall picks, I see a lot of Star Tycoons out there. So maybe the buzz will start. Maybe we're on the start of the wave here because this has been a big hit with family and with friends. I think this is a game a lot of hobby board gamers are just going to dig, especially people who normally may not give an economic game a look, because this gives you a bit of the feel of like some of the bigger engine builder games out there. And it gives you that feel of a stock market game without being unapproachable or unfathomable, or you don't need to pull out a calculator to play this. Like after playing with the trading rules, I could see this being a next step from Catan. And the way the market works and you build your engine actually reminds me a lot of Splendor. And I think if you had that basis, this game would be very approachable.
Overall, I just really love this one. I am wondering what the release date was on it. I'm curious. I want to go look it up now because I know we picked it up in the spring at Gamma Expo. And I don't know if it was out at that point or if we got a pre-release copy.
So I think sci-fi fans should consider this as a possible alternative to some economic games where the Victorian or fantasy themes even might turn you off.
Like, seriously, if you like tableau builders, check out Star Tycoon. Same thing goes for engine builders. If you like engine builders, check it out. If you like economic games, check it out. Like, this is just a tight game. And the big draw to me is that puzzle feel. So if you like that trying to figure out how to get that extra little bit by doing things in the right order with limited resources, I think you're going to really enjoy this. Plus that feeling of growth round after round. Like the end of round one feels very different than the end of round three in this game.
Stock market game fans should also check out Star Tycoon. While the market here is simpler than many economic games, playing the market can be key to victory. And while you aren't going to need your calculator, this will still fill that buy low, sell high itch.
Now, really, the only people I think should be wary of this game are the people who don't like Take That and hate drafting. This game can get a little on the nasty side once you open it up to negotiation. There are people who will take advantage of the no deals are binding rule.
Now, I have to shout out Good Games Publishing here to wrap this up for just having another hit, right? Like, it's been a bit since we've talked about their games. We haven't had anything new from them in a while, but we still haven't played a bad game from them. Like, check out our Unfair Guildmasters and Land versus Sea reviews just to see how great some of their games are.
That's true. We've pretty much enjoyed their stuff across the board. This is why Good Games Publishing is one of our favorite publishers. Do you have a publisher that you trust to put out games you know you're going to enjoy? Is there a company that if they make a game, you're willing to give it a shot before knowing anything else about it? We want to know who that is for you.
Let us know about it in the comments below wherever you found this review, or better yet, start up a conversation on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
Now, speaking of capitalism, have we mentioned the Tabletop Bellhop Patreon? For just the price of a cup of coffee a month, you can help poor content creators like us continue to do what we love. As thanks, we'll send you updates about our upcoming podcast episodes, copies of our show notes, and even bonus audio for those of you who can afford a couple cups a month.
Head to patreon.com/tabletopbellhop and start saving a starving content creator now. Every moment counts.
A new contender enters the ring. Welcome Bianca and Annika and their robot Kettle to the Robot Quest Arena.
The Kettle Robot Pack adds a lot more than just a new bot to your games of Robot Quest Arena. A deck-building board game of robot battles from Wise Wizard Games, who we do have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy of this expansion. Note, you do need a copy of Robot Quest Arena to use this, and if you don't know much about that, be sure to check out our review, which was part of episode 245 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
This is one of three robot packs that are currently available for Robot Quest Arena, and each of these includes a new bot you can play, additional health tracking tokens, new cards, and new battlefield tiles. They also each increase the player count of Robot Quest Arena by one, allowing you to play with more players or in larger team games.
What's most impressive is that each of these expansions also adds new rules to your games of Robot Quest Arena. These new cards just aren't more of the same type of cards you get in that base game. Instead, each features a totally new type of card.
Now, that new thing that Kettle adds to the game are green defense cards. These gain red cubes when played, and they stay in play protecting your bot. When your bot takes damage, cubes are removed from these cards first. And when they have no cubes on them, they just go to your discard and can come back up like any other card in your deck. Of course, having more cubes out there also means more victory points for your opponents to grab.
You also get a set of portals, a new battlefield tile that works pretty much how you'd expect it to. When on a portal, you can spend one move energy to move onto another portal that's in play.
Rules for these are found on cards, which is nice as you can just put them out on the table when including these new elements, something we wish they included in the base game.
Yeah, I'm tempted to print up my own cards for the base game for all the terrain types, at least. I gotta say, I love these expansions. Like, I love the way they're packaged. They kind of look like an old school action figure, something you'd find on the shelves at Toys R Us. And you can really see the bot, right? The figure. But it wasn't the bot, though, that shocked me. It was just how much content you get. Like, I thought you were getting a cool bot and maybe a few cards. I was not expecting a slew of new cards and had no clue until opening Kettle up that you actually get new card types.
Yeah, I think it's really cool that with each of these expansions, they included completely new rules. I mean, there is like also adorable robot, and I like the toyetic packaging, but yeah.
Whereas I'd done my research on Board Game Geek, and I knew that these were going to be super awesome, which is why I was so excited at Origins for us to pick these up.
And Kettle, as a bot, is cool. They have the standard health that everything else has, 5 health, 1 blue, 4 red. But they start with their own personal shield card. And they play much more defensively than the other bots we've seen. And I got to say, they match up well, and they seem well-balanced when compared to the base game bots.
I especially like how they added that 11th card into your starting deck, but when you play it, you draw a new card, so you're not losing out. The balance stays the same.
As for the new green defense cards, I dig them. They sounded a little overpowered at first, but then when I realized that really they're just more points for the other players to grab, knocking someone out, like, yeah, you get a bonus point for knocking them out, but that's not the majority of the game. Just doing damage is what you're getting points for. And that seemed to balance out based on the advantages. Now, what surprised me and what I didn't realize after reading, you know, the card that's in there that says what shields do is they're not just shields. Every single shield did something, which I thought was pretty cool. They don't do more than just providing defense. And some of those new things seem pretty powerful. And I got to say, throwing this in, you don't usually talk about meta games when you, I mean, you're not talking about like collectible card games, but playing with this changes the meta. Like, Robot Quest Arena evolved when I put this in. It is a slightly different game now than it was without this expansion.
Yeah, and I think the shields adds to the VP points in the game, so your scores overall are likely going to be higher. But as long as everyone isn't turtling, it shouldn't make a dramatic difference. Just be aware if you are tracking scores for some reason, the scores overall across the game will probably get a boost when Kettle and the defense cards are in play.
Overall, I did this, but, you know, we got to say the good with the bad. So if I had to pick some nits, adding defense cards does make the game longer. It's going to be harder to knock out bots, especially if people go all in on defense cards. And the FAQ for the game even suggests playing with less blue cubes if you do find the games are going long. So that's a nice simple fix. Now, another would be I would have liked 4 portal tiles. And I don't know why, but every time I set up a map in this game, I want it to be symmetric. I don't know why. It just the battlefields look better symmetric. Or I don't want to give like one starting position an advantage. And I just think with this new mechanic, it would have been cool to have 4 of them, right, instead of 3. I also would have liked, now that their shields are a thing, I want a basic shield. I want a new basic card everyone can buy that, you know, just provides one defense. I just think that now that shields are an option, they should be an option for everyone. And you shouldn't be reliant on the cards coming up in the deck. But you know what? Again, nitpicking.
Everyone make a note. Moe's just said he likes something symmetrical.
The bots and everything else in this game are so asymmetrical. I want the board to be symmetrical. So honestly, if you own and enjoy Robot Quest Arena, I don't see any reason you wouldn't want to pick this up. Kettle in particular seems really cool. I would recommend this even if it was just a few new cards of the existing types, but the fact that it adds defense cards is just awesome. The way I look at it, like Kettle's a new bot, like being the new bot and a cool new toy and a neat looking little orange kind of chunky dude is pretty cool. But that's actually the least interesting thing in this expansion. It's cool to have a new bot, but I'd love having more battlefield terrain and more options in the market and totally new options with new mechanics.
I love pleasant board game surprises. When a game is much better than I expect it to be, when component quality is even better than it looks in pictures, or when an expansion offers way more than you thought it would. What was your last pleasant board game surprise? Let us know in the comments or fire off an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com.
That was the double bell.
And that means it's time to wrap things up. Thanks to everyone who joined us live tonight for this special anniversary episode.
Before we sign off, we're going to take a moment to thank all of our awesome Patreon patrons. You know what would be a great birthday gift, though? If we had more names to add to this list next week. Brian Van Beek, thank you, Brian.
William Fisher, thank you.
Andrew Dacey, thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen Thomas, sorry we missed you last night. Thank you.
Sean P. Kelly, thanks, Sean. Hope that Delta Green game went well.
Derek Hissen, thanks, Derek.
Thanks to the members of the Misdirected Mark podcast, and thanks for the recommendation on Patreon.
Donna, thanks, Pax. Sorry you didn't stick around to the end.
Evil John, thank you, John.
Hey, Tycho, thank you.
Brian Kurtz, thanks, Brian.
Thank you, Chris Leary.
Diane Tuzano, thanks, Ma.
Ron F., thank you, Ron.
Thank you, Dukas.
Roger Malosh, who I'm kind of surprised didn't join us tonight, thank you.
Kat and Tori Dome, thank you, Kator.
Jeff and Sheila Seuss, thank you.
Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but we're also all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Now, something you can do that costs you nothing but a bit of your time is to interact with our content wherever you found it. Share it with your gaming friends, hit the thumbs up, like, etc. Leave a comment and interact with other people's comments.
Seriously, you have no idea how much we appreciate that. Also, be sure to subscribe on Spotify, Pandora, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen. If you're already a subscriber, how about leaving us a review to help others discover the show? That's all for us from tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And
game on.